That was the opening stage of the Tour of Britain. Welcome to stage two. Olaf Coy taking the opening stage that started in Altrincham and finished in Manchester after an absolutely sublime leave out by Wout van Aert. Sam Bennett there in third. Kanter, Vermeulen, Fredheim, Bomboy, Van Poppel. Last year's winner Serrano, a solid ninth. And the top ten rounded out by Rory Townsend. As you saw, a five-man break animated the day. The most to profit from the break was James Fouché, who is now in the King of the Mountains jersey. But let's have a look at today's stage. It starts in Wrexham. It finishes in Wrexham. It's short and sweet. 109.9 kilometres, the shortest stage of this year's race. In fact, the second shortest stage ever in the Tour of Britain. We head briefly north out of the city. We wend our way across the border into the neighbouring, well, back into England, through the beautiful lanes of Cheshire. There's only one categorised climb today. That's at Ayton. That comes with just under 20 kilometres to go. Shortly after that, there's the intermediate sprint for the green jersey. And then we finish with a technical run into the line in Wrexham. So as we had yesterday, it's quite a pleasant 15-minute roll out of this beautiful city, just over the border, nestled in the northwest of Wales. So only, well, that second foray into Wales will be the final stage of this race. The Tour of Britain has visited on numerous occasions. The last time we came to Wrexham, the victor on that occasion was Elia Viviani. That's the start line, and it will also be the finish line as well. Just a little bit of housekeeping for you. We've already seen that Olaf Coy is wearing that rather fetching retro-looking jersey there, the red and blue jersey of a race leader. He's also ensconced in the green jersey, but his teammate Wout van Aert will be wearing that today. In the white jersey of best young rider, he sits second overall in that classification, Istiaan Fredheim from the Uno X team. And in the black jersey of the Pinarello King of the Mountains is James Fouché. So that is the situation. Let's look at some of the riders just at the back, nice and relaxed. Tom Pidcock having a conversation with Stevie Williams. Stevie Williams, of course, a proud Welshman. Just in front there of one of the riders who we missed out in the sprint yesterday, Fernando Gaviria. So Mick Bennett waits, his sleeves rolled up. A gorgeous day here in Wales today. 21 degrees, set to top out at about 23 degrees. A gentle southeast to northwest wind blowing of around 8 kilometres an hour, which will mean for the final climb of the day, the only categorised climb of the day, that will have a little bit of a tailwind, which could prove interesting. Not the steepest of climbs, but you just never know. And the countdown begins to the rollout of stage two of the 19th edition of the Tour of Britain. Well, off they go. The flag has dropped. And I think, well, let me just open the door. Brian Smith, great to have you alongside me again today, Brian. Yesterday, the classic Tour of Britain stage, wasn't it? I think the takeaway for me was the magnificent crowds and just the might of Jumbo-Visma.
Yeah, I spoke to a few of the staff on site this morning for various reasons, and, you know, I actually complimented them. You know, they were really enthused with the amount of, you know, spectators they saw out in stage one. And likewise here in Wrexham, it's sometimes nice. A lot of bike races you come, watch, and it's gone in seconds. And I think this is a nice lap round Wrexham, because you can come in, you know, for breakfast, enjoy watching the start, and stay pretty much all day for the finish. So, you know, it could be a good day out. Maybe go in somewhere and, you know, watch it on Eurosport GCN and then come out and watch the finish. So, yeah, I think it'll be a nice day out in Wrexham for everybody. And, you know, looking at the weather conditions, almost perfect, you know, when you consider other races in different parts of the world at the moment and the treacherous conditions they've got. I think it's going to be pretty much almost perfect all week.
It looks like it. I've had a look at long-range forecast, Brian, and you're quite right, all the way through to the week. The weekend when the race finally finishes in Caerphilly. There's a couple of ascents of Caerphilly Mountain. The Queen stage of the race will wrap up the final general classification. Yeah, the weather looks absolutely fantastic, and indeed into the following week. But let's be fair, bro, we had an absolutely awful summer. I was in France most of July, but back home it was grim. So we are getting a lovely, beautiful late summer. And as you say, Brian, they've had awful conditions, well, treacherous conditions in the Vuelta yesterday. And the race was split apart in the early stages by the wind, shortened because of landslides. None of that here at the Tour of Britain. And again, Brian, we're going to enjoy today's stage for a couple of reasons, because we're just looking forward to the racing. But again, and again, sorry about this, folks at home, it does venture onto our old training roads again, doesn't it? So it's been a definite couple of days for potentially reminiscing. I might get a bit nostalgic as we head towards Bunbury and just around there and Beeston Castle.
Fill your boots, Matt. You know, if anybody's listening at the moment, if you want to know where the best tea stops are, Matt's your man.
Indeed, well, we go past a little place called Malpas as well today. So where we are in relation to Great Britain, we're in the northwest, just across the border into Wales, that's Wrexham, and we're not too far away from the Cheshire border, which merges as well with the Shropshire border, and we actually move not too far away from Whitchurch, which is where a place I used to live, and just down the road is Crewe and Nantwich, another place where I used to live, as we hear a bit of a conversation there with Luke Rowe and Alexander Richardson of St Pirren. St Pirren had a fantastic day yesterday. Two riders in the breakaway, Zeb Kiffin and Jack Rootkin-Gray. But all the rewards for breakaways today, save for the most aggressive rider, Brian, are really back-loaded. All we have now is today's one categorised climb at the back, and that comes after around 190 kilometres of racing, so there's not a lot on offer for the breakaways today at all on the first, well, the first three-quarters of the race.
You can look at it in two ways. You can look at it as very short stage. If you get a strong breakaway like we had yesterday, five riders, you know, with very relative, you know, metres gained, you can ride a team time trial pretty much and not hold anything back. It's not as if it's a long stage, 109.9 kilometres. Just noticed in the light blue again, just behind the race director's car, was Harry Tanfield. There he is, popping up in that, you know, pink and yellow bike. And he said yesterday didn't feel too good. There are other days. I think this day suits him better. It's shorter, it's about a kind of more powerful breakaway. Yet again, we might see Harry Tanfield in the breakaway. I was a little bit surprised, and I'm going to rename it. I renamed the King of the Mountains to the King of the Hills. I think the most combative awards went to Harry Tanfield yesterday with over 77% of the vote. I'm going Mr. Popular Award, because that's what it is, because I feel that Harry Tanfield wasn't, in my book, the most combative rider dropping back. I thought it should have gone to either the UnoX rider or, in fact, you know, almost the last man standing, Zeb Kiffin of St Pirren. Almost, you know, having two riders in the breakaway, I really thought that, you know, the team of St Pirren deserved to be on the podium yesterday, but it wasn't meant to be. Tour of Britain organisation have decided to do it on social media, I believe, and we're going to call it the most popular rider from now on.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. And quite often, race organisers will... Another race that does a Twitter vote or a social media vote is the Arctic Race of Norway. But that isn't always the most aggressive rider. I think, like you say, most aggressive rider is awarded generally quite fairly as we look at... I think that's Ben Turner, unshipped his chain. What exactly happened there with... Is he clipped something or did he just... laid it down as well. That is the last thing that... it's Rodriguez. Yeah, Carlos Rodriguez, former Spanish road champion, stage winner, remember, in the Tour de France, before sliding a little bit down the classification after that awful off he had. Such a talent. But not a particularly good start to his day in Wrexham. But no, Brian, it is an interesting one. I do, as much as I like Harry Tanfield, he is an aggressive rider. I do agree it should have gone to Frederik Versnes or Zeb Kiffin or even Jack Rootkin-Gray yesterday. But there we go. So I think, yeah, we should rename it the Most Popular Rider Award.
maybe the Most Popular Rider in the Breakaway Award.
Yes, the Most Popular Rider in the Breakaway Award. But yeah, there's Most Aggressive Rider, Most Combative Rider. Generally, it's awarded by the race jury. And quite often is actually decided with about 20Ks to go as well.
Indeed,
so that can
yes.
be quite controversial as well. So, especially if something happens late on. And that's quite often why we see breakaways fragment right near the back end, and it is almost a last man standing, because there's quite a lot of prestige, Brian, to visit the podium in a big race, isn't there, for the team, and to get that most aggressive rider. And in races like the Tour de France, you'll actually get a different coloured number, a different coloured dossard as well. So there's some real prestige assigned to it.
There is. Any visit to the podium is worth it for any team. And I know a lot of teams don't target it, but if you're not getting up in the sprints competition or the King of the Mountains, you can always try for that kind of competition. And like you say, in some races, you get awarded a different colour or number. But in this race, they've decided to do the... the vote out to the public vote, and quite impressive that Harry Tanfield is very, very popular.
It certainly is. A Yorkshire lad, and I would imagine there'd have been a lot of people out on the roads yesterday, well, there were, calling his name. Just looking back through some of the riders' social media accounts yesterday, Brian, and pretty much every rider to a man was just impressed with the crowds. Wonderful atmosphere. Tom Pidcock posted some lovely pictures up and said, what a day. Just finished outside the top 10 in the sprint, but in terms of the atmosphere and also in terms of the time of the year this race is, it's a perfect point in the calendar, normally just before the World Championships, as we were describing yesterday. This year is slightly different because of the Glasgow Super Worlds, which has come a lot earlier. But I'm not saying there's an end of term, Phil, because we've still got a good 6 to 8 weeks worth of racing.
We head deep into October. Most kids,
but it is it's a start term. But for the riders, there's just a nice. There's always been a lovely, warm feeling about this race, despite how hard it is. That's for sure. As they continue to roll north, we head bang on due north for a few k's, heading towards Gresford, and then it's not long before we actually go through a place called Holt, which signifies crossing the border from Wales, into England. We then loop around Tatnall, Burwardsley, Bickerton, Bewkley, Malpas. There is a great cafe in Malpas. And then we head back into Wales. And then we actually cross the border twice. So go out, in, out, and in again. So we're crisscrossing the border. And the break already has started, so the flag has dropped, 108.8 k's to go, and already we have a launch, and it does look like that's Alexander Richardson this time.
Yeah, seated effort, calculated. I think he's thinking more short stage, big powerhouse. Harry Tanfield, I suspected, wanting to get involved with this. It looks like Urenstad of Uno X, they're riding aggressively as well, the Norwegian team, coming here to try and see what they can do. But yeah, definitely Richardson and Tanfield, two big powerhouses. We've seen Richardson go for the stage in the Tour of Britain last year. And again, this year, a lot of teams will be thinking, shorter stage, get out there, nothing much to worry about. It's just going to come down to the power in the end.
It certainly is. The stage you're referring to, the stage to Sunderland, won by a rider that's in this field as well, Kemiel Bunyu of Team Flanders Balois. It does look like it's the man who was in the move yesterday that's there at the moment. So straight away, a counter-attack on the left-hand side. And we do need to doff our cap to TDT Unibet. David Bomboy of Belgium up there in the sprint yesterday. He's already had some good rides and some decent top 10. Seventh place on the stage for him, as well as having Harry Tanford on the break. And they've already just put somebody solo up the road there as well. But Brian, I'm expecting today to be a little bit different. Tanfield's going again. Just by the way, he was sat on the front there. This is going to be a hard one today, isn't it? But the GC teams, the main teams that we saw driving yesterday, Jumbo-Visma and Ineos Grenadiers, are going to want to try and keep a lid on this. They cannot afford for a break to probably get more than a minute and a half on today's stage.
Well, let's see what happens, because I think it was a dominant performance by Jumbo-Visma yesterday. I know they finished first and second, but even finishing in second there for Wout van Aert, we talked about it yesterday about having no time bonuses, and I know Tom Pidcock was trying to get up there, but obviously just very difficult. And today's stage, Matt, is another tricky one. A tricky run in the last kind of kilometre.
Yeah, totally.
Into Wrexham, and it's very, very narrow as well. So it's another one you have to be in great position with about 10 kilometres to go.
Yeah, we're just showing the early rollout. Another rider has gone clear from the TDT Unibet cycling team. No, you're quite right, Brian. I was having a closer look at this profile. We've got a couple of little kickers at the start, but nothing too much. In total, over the 109.9 kilometres, there's 1,002 metres of elevation, which isn't insignificant, but the between kilometres 10 and 35, it's pretty much pan flat, bar for one or two little rollers. A few little climbs the midsection, but then the last 20 Ks is quite interesting, isn't it? There's no big climbs, but the terrain is what we call grippy. The only categorised climb of the day at Ayton is 1.9 Ks at 2.7%, but then it keeps on climbing, and there's another climb after the intermediate sprint, and then a very fast running. So if anybody does want to take it up, I do think there's possibilities. We could see some splits on the run into the line.
Possibly, yeah, because it is tricky. It gets narrow, goes on to some kind of paving stones as normal you see in some city centres. But this is an interesting one here. First time we've really caught eyes on Jacob Scott. Jacob Scott, renowned in Tour of Britain history for, you know, King of the Mountains titles, and such a great rider. So he's there in the purple. Looks like the Scots, and I'm going to fly that flag today. Finn Crockett is in this breakaway as well for St Pirren, together with you know, one of the riders there for that team that you mentioned, the TDT Unibet team. So three riders have got a slight advantage. Still got on.
That's Callum Ormiston getting across the gap to the riders you just mentioned, Brian, of the Global 6 cycling team. And I think we'll call that a citrus-coloured kit. Very distinctive. But yeah, the unmistakable figure of Jacob Scott. We spoke so much about him over the last couple of years. And as you say, twice a winner of the King of the Mountains title. And at least one occasion as well has won the Intermediate Sprints classification. A classification that is no longer with us. We do have intermediate sprints, but there's no time bonuses and there's no separate sprints jersey as we've had in the past. Only four jerseys allowed in the UCI race, but there's been a crash on the corner.
Gaviria.
Well, I didn't quite notice that. Yes, Gaviria's come down on that roundabout as this break continues to move clear now. Only 2 or 3 kilometres into the race now, but this Ormiston doing a great job, the man from South Africa, 23 years of age. Just about to latch onto the back of this group. That was a big, big effort, but any later, that would have been pretty hard to get across, Brian. It looks like we could have possibly the break of the day that's gone very early, just looking at the fact there's a distinct lack of any real reaction from the peloton now.
Yeah, there's no reaction now. It was a very tentative start. It was across the road, and then we saw a seated effort from Alex Richardson, and you know, I think St Pirren wanted a rider in the breakaway. They have managed to do that in the shape of Finn Crockett. Bolton in the purple have got their man there. I think that Jacob Scott would, you know, be thinking more about, you know, getting in a breakaway, thinking more for a kind of King in the Mountains. But this is a four-up team time trial now. And, you know, I think the team, you know, we were talking about it just early on, and the way they rode yesterday, I think Jumbo-Visma, I think everybody will lean on them. You know, with the performance yesterday and what they did was phenomenal, and you know, they came away with the rewards. I do think that Ineos Grenadiers, not too sure if they'll be interested in maybe riding. It's more safety than anything else, but yeah, group of four, which is manageable, but then again, some of these teams might not know the couple of the riders that are in there. So we've got a strong enough breakaway that could do something similar to what we saw yesterday, and you know what it's like riding in this part of the world, Matt. These are kind of rolling roads, but you can keep up a good average speed.
Yep, they've averaged well over 50 k's an hour already. These are the couple of kickers that I was talking about before we get onto the first flat opening stretch. Just some small little climbs as we look at the composition of our four leaders. Almost Abraham Stockman is the man representing TDT Unibet, Jacob Scott and Finn Crockett. That is the move that has gone clear. As you can see, 103 k's to go, the shortest stage by a long way in this year's Tour of Britain. Previous shortest stage was only 85 kilometres, but yeah, this is going to be short and sweet. They do have a long transfer. I'm thinking, just you were talking earlier on, Brian, about the fact that I think this might be a theme going forwards, that a city, a town can have a day of festivities, see the start, they can have events around it, logistically a little bit less of a challenge as well, a slightly smaller carbon footprint. But what this gives the field an opportunity to do with this slightly shorter distance today is get across to the East Riding, because it's Goole to, east to Beverley, should I say, tomorrow. And that is a pretty hefty transfer from Wales across to Humberside.
It is, so especially when you go cross-country, yeah. Matt. And, you know, it's such a beautiful part of the world. It's great riding. I used to love riding around this way because it was just kind of undulating. You know, when I used to live in Cheshire, it was either into the Peak District or over towards kind of Alton Towers and Stoke-on-Trent with the short hills. Or if you wanted a kind of long, steady, you know, quite quick ride, you know, you do 5-6 hours here. Okay, you can venture out a little bit more after Wrexham. It goes into, you know, Wales, and, you know, there's a few good climbs over that way. But, yeah, nice rolling, kind of quite fast roads. But, you know, these four riders have got a good advantage. I think as we see the peloton, they will allow them a couple of minutes, but I think Jumbo-Visma will be on the front again. Whether they get much help, because they didn't yesterday in the run in towards the finish.
No.
So they were kind of left to their own devices, and I think very similar to yesterday, if they get it right again, they look unstoppable. So the only way of doing it is to try and tire them out, try to get them to use more of their teammates. I said in the run-in yesterday that Stephen Kruijswijk and Joost van Emden, if they were left to ride down the breakaway, that wasn't coming back, and I didn't think it would come back. So they had to gamble, they had to put more firepower on the front, but they still had the firepower to deliver a 1-2. Amazing.
Yeah, it certainly was. That was a real demonstration of just of class and just raw power. They just got that much collective might between them. Had a little bit of assistance early on just to hold that gap so it didn't go out from Ineos, particularly Luke Rowe, for the first two-thirds of the stage, essentially. Then some big pulls from the Bora Hansgrohe duo of Ida Schelling and in particular Nils Pollitt, but then they just took it up again themselves, didn't they? Kruijswijk put in that enormous shift on the front to finally bring things almost back together. Fatigue played its part as well, but right now this, I think, is going to be the break of the day. I can't see any action happening from behind, and there we go. It's as you were in relation to what we saw yesterday. The man on the front, Joost van Emden, and behind him it looks like the very familiar figure of Luke Rowe as well. There's a couple of riders here dropping back. Carlos Verona, he's on his way next year, isn't he? A transfer has been announced for Carlos Verona. Actually, I can't remember where he's going. Where is he going?
Not a big team, but a little team.
Oh, Little Trek. Thank you very much, Little Trek. I got myself into a conversational cul-de-sac there, Brian. I remember seeing it on Instagram, and then I forgot where he's heading to. Lidl Trek doing a lot of recruiting, not here at the Tour of Britain this year. As Olav Koy just moves up on the inside, back into position at the head of affairs in that blue jersey with the white band across, and then with the red sleeves, reminiscence of the Great Britain kit back in the day. I'm sure that's been the thinking of the race organisers. As our group continues to work well together, four riders out in front, Jacob Scott, 28 years of age now, from Oldham. Solid, solid performer. It was in 2021 and 2019 that he took those King of the Mountains awards in the Tour of Britain. And here he is on the front. Good mountain biker as well. But very, very strong. He's got that sharp
British
acceleration.
British champion, was it? Endurance champion
was.
last year?
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Indeed, Enduro champion. So, exceptionally versatile. He's also been second twice in that King of Mountains in 2017 and 2022. So, an exceptionally good record. Fifth in the Rutland, or sixth in the Rutland Melton this year. Our own version, Britain's version of the Tour of Flanders, drops onto the back wheel. The man on the front has had a good win already this season. Won a stage for the Tour of Rwanda, Callum Ormiston. Very strong South African. But already, again, Brian, just under 100k's to go now, and they've actually cut this lead to 50 seconds. They can't afford to give this one too much. And I'm wondering if any of the teams are minded to try and do something in the final section of this race, because of the reasons we talked about. It is difficult terrain. We know how much might they've got. Do you think they might try and thin things out, or do you think they might want to share things out amongst Olav Koy and Wout van Aert today? It's an interesting, wasn't it? Koy has got that victory. He is the purest sprinter, but the back end today suggests that it might suit Wout van Aert a bit more. I don't know.
Yeah, it's a little bit more technical. If they do what they did yesterday, it'll be another Olaf Koy win, I think, with the help of Wout van Aert. But you're right that they're here in two fronts. They want stage wins, but you know they all also want the title. It's a case of, and dare I say it, if you go into that kind of final phase, which is pretty tricky, there's a lot of left and right, and it's very narrow. If Olaf Koy was on Wout van Aert's wheel and just happened to let it go, then I think there would be a great interest there. Whether they use that tactic, because we've seen it, you know, happen in the past, or whether they just make sure they kind of guarantee it, but they know that that's up their sleeve if they want to use it. It is a trick it's used, especially when it's very, very narrow, when you're going into some of, you know, the final corners. But let's see what develops. But it does look as if Ineos Grenadiers doing what they did yesterday, just making sure that breakaway kept in check. The thing is, the reason why they're not giving them too much as well, because they can't afford to. There's four strong riders here. I know that all the teams will not know. They might be listening to us, I don't know, and we are bigging these guys up. And we're bigging them up because, you know, they're strong. You know, we know them all. You've just rhymed off some of the kind of palmaris of what they've done. Finn Crockett is a really strong rider, can sprint a bit. Commonwealth Games bronze medal in Birmingham last year, and you know he's won quite a few races. You mentioned the Cycling Classic as well, so strong rider. And I think he went over to ride the Ross before he signed for St Pirin this year, and you know had some good results over there. So let's see what they can do, but they won't be given too much rope at all today, because at the same time, Matt, Yves van Emmeren and Luke Rowe, they know that for the next kind of couple of hours, they can on these roads, they can bowl all along at a decent tempo and just hold that gap down. You look at the roads here, and the wind's not blowing. You can look at the trees here. Nothing really to shout about. It's going to be a nice loop round Wrexham with a very interesting final.
Yeah, it certainly is. We'll talk a little bit about that as we get a bit nearer, but it is even more technical than the run-in yesterday. The run-in yesterday was primarily on big, wide main roads before we swept into the city centre in Manchester, ending up on Deansgate. A couple of lefts and rights, the final left-hander with only 300 metres to go. But by then, the field was in one long line. But Wrexham, it is a city, but it's far smaller than the city of Manchester. Narrow roads, and there was one particularly acute left-hander, then a right, then another left before we head into the finish line. So the last kilometre, peppered with technical difficulties, and the peloton will be acutely aware of that. But then they'll be carrying quite a lot of speed as well. They're losing elevation for the last 8 kilometres as we drop down into Wrexham, so the approach will be fast as well. And that is another thing that the peloton will be aware of, not to give this break too much. We saw how difficult it was. I mean, there were some interviews with some of the riders who were riding on the front yesterday for Jumbo-Visma, and they did say it was hard. The brake were riding very, very strongly, and it wasn't easy to bring them back. We saw the facial expression of Kruijswijk and Niels Pollitt in the closing stages as they had to lift that pace to erode the time that they'd been built by the breakaways. It was hard, and they can't afford to do that. You can't afford to give a break like that 30 seconds with 8Ks to go on a downhill run to the line, can you? So they're going to have to approach this one differently and keep things on a far tighter leash today.
Anybody who watches cycling knows that the capabilities of Niels Pollitt and Ida Schelling, and you know they were doing hard turns at the front and then drifting back after doing their turns. And even Yves van Emden, he thought his day was over and had to get called back. In the interview of Olaf Koy, he said, you know, it was hard. And, you know, the last kind of 10 kilometres, the run in. And it's hats off to the riders that were in that breakaway yesterday, because they rode their skin, out their skin. And, okay, they get brought back in the end, but they made them work. And I think it's the information, the motivation, knowing that, you know, guys had pulled off the front, and you know other people have been thrown into the mix to try and kind of help out. But just the way that Jumbo-Visma kind of managed things, I thought maybe one or two other teams would have went up and kind of helped out, Movistar being one of them. But you know, looking at Gaviria was nowhere yesterday. I hope he's okay. We've not seen anything of Gaviria. We saw him on the deck, and you know they have got last year's winner who was, you know, ninth, and it just goes to show you that that was no fluke last year. You know, he's a good rider, good sprinter as well, and, you know, delivered that stage win and took the overall title, albeit it was cut short last year's race. But this tempo, you know, kind of one line, this will be all day today, and it's not going to be a long day. It's one of these situations. It was the same I talked about racing in one of the kind of amateur Tour of Britain, although some of the pros rode it in the milk race. We decided where the race lead in the last day was, instead of letting the brake go and just kind of riding, we just went to the front straight away and decided that we were just going to ride tempo from the start. And it looks as if that's what Jumbo, Visma and Ineos Grenadiers have decided themselves. Just get on the front and just ride tempo. Just get this stage safe, over with. And this stage is going to be like it is now. It's just going to be lined out, one line. Tempo's going to be high. It could be, you know, one of the kind of faster stages in the history of the Tour of Britain. These guys have to do a four-up team time trial. I've done one of these in the past, or a few of these in the past, at 100 kilometres, but maybe, yeah, it's just team time trial in the past used to be 100 kilometres, four riders, and, you know, this is what these guys will have to do today.
Yeah, if anybody are wondering what Brian is talking about, viewers of a certain age, wherever you are in the world, will be familiar with the team time trial. Oh, well, there's the injury on the left-hand side of the hip of Carlos Rodriguez, 22 years of age, and had that little crash in the neutral zone. Looks okay, but certainly isn't the way he wants to start today's stage. Just behind, that's Danny van Poppel. They've changed the order. There is our first proper glimpse of Matt Walls. Good to see him riding. He's had such a difficult couple of seasons after winning the Olympic Games, Omnium, with injuries. But it's good to see him back in the mix. But he'll be used in a slightly different way today. Set the tempo early on. And also, the Ineos Grenadiers are clearly they're going to use Rodriguez early on. Whereas we had Luke Rowe yesterday, and it looked like Connor Swift was going to be used. So the team's just changing their riders around a little bit, rotating them. And that's something we often see as well. We always see one or two stalwarts doing the early mileage. But as the pace is a bit higher and a bit more intense, they might need fresher legs at the front here, Brian, as well.
I think by the looks of things, Ineos Grenadiers have been called back. There's no need. The gap's only 28 seconds. So it's, you know, put a rider on the front, as I said yesterday. That gives you the kind of right to ride in the front. So they've got their place. So it's about looking after Tom Pidcock, and that's what they're going to do. It does look as if it's been left all up to Jumbo-Visma. It'll be interesting to see if they do get any help. And it looks as if they may get some help from Bora today, because, you know, they'll want to go for a sprint stage. But it does look as if initially, when that gap was going up, it was Ineos Grenadiers that decided. But now that I think they've kind of called the troops off, so they're going to leave it. As long as Joost van Emden is happy, you know, this gap is at half a minute, then, you know, they're happy to let it be at the moment. And the workload is on the shoulders of the boys in yellow.
Indeed. Yeah. We'll have a little look just to see if one of the riders from Bora does give a hand, because it does look as if they're stacked up behind to do something. Just going through Holt. We are in England now. And we're heading in a northeasterly direction, looping round before we head south. They'll have a bit of a crosswind for the second part of today's stage, and the final run-in, there will be a little bit of a tailwind and then a crosswind to the finish. But as Brian was just alluding to, there's not much wind at all today. A benign day in terms of the wind, hardly a cloud in the sky as they continue to wend their way through these little lanes. Plenty of warnings from the NEG group. That little pinch point there, cars parked on either side of the road. But yeah, this particular section are pretty flat. For the first 20 or 30 Ks, midway through, we start a little bit of elevation. The road becomes slightly more rolling. Then it continues to undulate. Then we get a proper little bit of elevation in the last 20 Ks. The only climb of the day that's categorised comes at a place called Ayton. That's with 19.7 Ks to go. They crest that climb. And very shortly afterwards is the only intermediate sprint towards the green jersey classification. That comes at 15.3. It then flattens. But then there's quite a long kicker of about 3 Ks. There's like a 3 K long drag, Brian, isn't there? Before the final run down to the line. And that's where I think we could see some splits. And I'm wondering if Ineos Grenadiers are maybe thinking about being a little bit disruptive there and trying to shake things out a little bit to give Pidcock a chance in a smaller group, perhaps.
Potentially, just a moment of interest there in Holt. See the rider at the back here just having a bit of a problem, Gaviria, after his crash. But just going over, this is the border between Wales and England, just going over the bridge here in Holt. The bridge was bitterly fought over the English Civil War and controlled access to Chester from Wales. And a small factoid is H.G. Wells was briefly a teacher at the Holt Academy here. So a little bit of history, and we'll try and kind of bring you up to speed with stuff like that throughout the stage. But yeah, I remember Tour of Britain in 2012, and I was there with the Enduro Racing, and what we decided to do is take the race on with a third division team. Decided to take it on in a narrow part of the parkour, and unfortunately there was a kind of narrow in and a bridge, and there was a crash behind, and there was only a front group of about 30 went into the park, and to fight out the finish, and I think there was a crash as they entered the park as well. So it was an interesting ride on, and there are opportunities that you can take advantage of kind of narrow roads, and that it wouldn't be a surprise if somebody tried that. But I think in a day like today, the more chance you've got of maybe splits would be pretty much in the last kind of couple of kilometres, not very technical finish.
Yeah, definitely. It's again, the climbing at the back end of the race, there is elevation, but the climbing isn't super steep. The only climb of the day, as we said, that is categorised is only 2.7% average. It's really hardly a climb. It's more of a drag. It then levels out, kicks again. But again, it only looks like it's 3%, but it's about 3 or 4Ks long. So if somebody does start to attack there, especially riders, teams with that little bit of extra local knowledge. And I know that I don't know exactly which domestic teams would have done any recons. I'm not too sure, but I know when I was managing the Sigma Sports team, we used to ride, because we had the luxury of doing that, because we're based here. We went and rode some of the key stages. And I know other teams rode key stages too. And in the absence of absolute firepower, what you do have up your sleeve as a British team on these British roads is where to be at the right time and attacking in a very disruptive place where it's hard to get organised and chase, especially towards the back end. And that little bit of local knowledge, especially guys like Matt Bramier, John Herity, who managed the GB team, although I think they'll be all around Ethan Vernon today. I don't think it's quite hard enough to really rip the race apart, but those little bits of local knowledge can really be valuable. And but again, there's so much open source information. Things have changed from 20, 30 years ago, where you could really keep those things secret, because everything is mapped out now. They've got so much data available at their fingertips. But still, local knowledge does play a part, that is for certain. As our brake continues to ride at pretty much the same speed as the bunch behind, they are keeping things on an exceptionally short leash today. And as you say, Brian, before I diverted, proper team time trial formation. And just to finish my point that I was starting earlier on, there was a discipline in the World Championships, in the amateur side of the equivalent to the under-23s now, there's a 100-kilometre team time trial. Four riders rode, for 100Ks in this formation, and it was absolutely brutal. I never rode the Worlds, but I did one or two of them, and I can safely say I'd never want to do them again. It was in the Olympics as well, wasn't it? There was the Olympic... It was an Olympic discipline as well, wasn't it? 100K team time trial. So, pretty brutal.
At junior level, it used to be 70 kilometres. It was quite hard. And I remember riding one Scottish Championships up in Aberdeen. And let's say it wasn't your typical time trial course. It was very undulating. We see Gaviria here at the medical car. Most times, the medical car is a soft top. I actually get a question from a couple of people and saying, why is it there a soft top, the medical car? It just means that, to change or to clean someone and for the doctor to get out the side of the car, you've got limited space. We see this often in races where the mechanic is leaning out the window. Very awkward for them. So the reason why is, they can have the soft top down. And it means that if anybody needs any cleaning, bandaged up and things like that, it's easier for the medical staff to be able to do that with a soft top car.
Yeah.
Sometimes they get wet though.
They sometimes get wet, but I think it's fair to say there'll be a big risk in getting a soft top car, medical car, for the Tour of Britain. So, I think I can see logistically why they do that in the Tour de France and in other big races on continental Europe. But our weather is, let's say, not overly reliable. But for this week, the information we've got so far from the meteo is that we're going to have superb weather all week. So riders topping up their tans. But alas, we have a non-soft top medical car. As we look at Jacob Scott, just making sure his socks are fully elevated. Most riders now are using these aero socks. You know what? I've never worn a pair of aero socks. Big fan of cotton. I don't really go very fast anymore, Brian, but I've never worn aero socks. Maybe I just should, just to see what they feel. Have you ever worn a pair of aero socks?
I haven't, no.
Thank you for that, Brian. Not quite the same. We're just buzzing to the cafe and back. I'm just looping around the lanes. Just had a little text, actually, from Richard Pascoe, who's in the team car. Probably sat behind Steve Lampier. Good afternoon, gentlemen. Both chaps know very well. Currently, we're talking a lot about St Pirin because they're at the front of the race. Their active Finn Crockett is in that move, as Brian was saying. The young Scott, a lot of potential. They're trying to get, or looking at the possibility of getting an Espoir team, an under-23 team, in addition to their continental team for next year. Still a lot of planning, a lot of discussions needed with British Cycling and some other additional sponsors, but they are a team and a setup with great ambition. But again, they're not here to make up the numbers, they're here to make a difference, and they're doing a good job, and they're forcing the peloton here to really chase. This isn't easy at all because we've got this shorter stage, almost half the distance of most stages in this race. Approximately, the intensity is going to be far higher. But what we're seeing, Brian, as well, is just generally speaking, across the board, the intensity of racing is now changing, which in turn is having a knock-on effect to the way riders recover and the way they fuel. There is a cost to races getting faster and faster, and it's not an easy one, is it? It's just riders training differently, recovering differently, taking on a lot more fuel, but it's something that's happened really only in the last few years.
Definitely, it's attention to all the details, isn't it? You know, you look back at some old archive footage in black and white, when, you know, we used to use kind of smaller gears than they do now, and I would say in general more cyclists were a little bit more muscular than they are today, and then you see the kind of changes, and now you go into the peloton, and although riders look kind of bigger, you know, on television, the most bike riders now are so skinny, and you know, that seems to be the kind of trait. And not even, you know, we used to finish races and, you know, we used to get a rice and pasta, but even that is rationed. You know, they know exactly whether it's, you know, 350 grams, 400 or, you know, 250 grams, that's what, you know, each individual requires. You know, you're getting weighed in and weighed out. You know, that's purely on, you know, the fluid. So it's all these details, and I know that Team Sky called them marginal gains, and not one thing can you change, you know, make your superstar. It's about a dozen different things, even more, that you have to look at, not just in racing, but as you mentioned, in training, because we used to do over 100 days of racing. Nowadays they're doing maximum about 80 days of racing, so they're coming in a little bit fresher, they're having to kind of train harder, they're using various different things. You know, power meters and core temperature meter, everything like that, and it's just ongoing and ongoing. And you know, dare I say it? It's, you know, these riders have become, you know, very robotic and very strict. And even in itself, you have to look at it. It's like being a prize fighter boxer. You can't just eat anything. You have to kind of measure everything. And sometimes that's kind of very difficult, because if your friends, family, whatever are doing their thing and going on holiday and, you know, having a few beers or just eating what they want, you have to be so disciplined, and that's where the mental side comes in as well.
Yeah, it certainly is a fascinating subject to talk about, but what I will focus on just there, we've had a real close-up lingering shot of the right hand of Fernando Gaviria. By the way he's holding the hoods, is taking some skin off his palm. There's no doubt about it. A lot of riders, I'd say about half and half. Half the peloton wear gloves, half don't. Some riders don't like it. It's absolutely fine. But what they do offer up with that slightly padded palm is if you do lay it down, which happens quite a lot. We've already seen two crashes from two very high-profile riders today. But one of the first things that you put down when you crash is your hands, or that soft skin on your palm. There's a danger of it being taken off. For a lot of riders, they still don't like them, but I think every single rider in this front group is wearing gloves, and that's one of the main reasons. But Gaviria is holding the bars in a way that suggests he's taken a fair bit of skin off his palm there, which isn't great, Brian, is it? Especially looking at any potential sprint later on today, although Max Cantor is sprinting very well for Movistar, so they've got an able backup plan. But that didn't look good for Gaviria. He shook his head when offered a pad to put on his hand, but clearly he's in a lot of pain there, and it wasn't holding the bars particularly firmly.
No, it will be a concern. Like you say, they've got plan B, which is Cantor not having much luck recently. And, you know, if this is the case, then I think we might not see him get involved with the sprint today. If he does, it's possibly a kind of help for Max Cantor more than anything. It's very difficult when you have that. And I was, you know, an advocate of not riding with any gloves, and everybody said, why would you not ride gloves? If you crash, you have that. Well, quite fortunately, over my career, I landed more in my elbows and knees than I did in my hands. So I just didn't like gloves at all. I like to hold the bars, feel the bars without anything kind of interfering with that. And unfortunately for Gaviria, this is an injury that he will have to use when it comes to sprinting. But we mentioned it yesterday, he crashed out the World Championships. He's now crashed today. Not the best.
No, not a good start for the Colombian. But 81Ks to go now, just over 37 seconds for our breakaway. Callum Ormiston is there for the Global 6 cycling team. He's the man just on the front at the moment in that citrus, almost acidic green jersey. Abraham Stockman, the Belgian, is there for the TDT Unibet cycling team. Sat third wheel, also in the mix as well. Finn Crockett in the black of St Pirin, and then Jacob Scott in the purple and yellow of the Bolton Equities Black Spoke team, also there in the mix as well. All of those riders finished safely in the peloton yesterday. There's only a few riders out at the back, including Gaviria, for that crash yesterday. 2 minutes and 24 seconds down. As we continue to wend their way through these beautiful Cheshire country lanes. Chester off to the left, as you can see. Another beautiful city. But this is a stretch of road that I know very, very well. This was actually part of my commute back in the 90s when I used to work, live in Crewe, and worked in Chester. As we look, our first proper glimpse today of the mighty figure of Wout van Aert. This man is so talented, so, so strong. And the way that he led out yesterday was just absolutely incredible, and slotted back into the wheel to secure that second place for another 1-2 for the squad. But yeah, they're basically riding the opposite way to my commute now, Brian, which is again a little moment of nostalgia for me.
So your Strava records are okay for the moment, then, if it's the opposite direction?
Yeah, this should be okay. I don't think I think Strava was just written down on bits of paper back then. But no, it's actually pretty flat run. We're basically heading now in a westerly direction. So easterly direction, should I say. Heading deeper into Cheshire, heading towards Beeston Castle. This is known as the Cheshire Plains. It's an absolutely gorgeous part of the world, part of the country. A lot of agriculture. Back in the 1940s, 50s, 60s, it was there was multiple dairy farms in this area. They've now been reduced considerably, but it is still a beautiful part of the world. And as we head towards Beeston Castle, that was a location for the filming of the Robin Hood Prince of Thieves film back in the 1990s with Kevin Costner. So Beeston Castle, you can see it for miles. Because we're on these Cheshire Plains, we've got these little climbs that rise out. We do ride over the shoulder of Beeston Castle, actually. There's Peckerton Castle, which is within the same sight line as well, just a couple of kilometres away. Two of these castles built on these natural mounds, these natural climbs, But this particular area in a few cases actually gets quite rolling. Nothing particularly steep. They don't actually go right to the top of these climbs, but over the shoulder there's a couple of quite nice drags, isn't there, Brian?
There is. It's but it's more kind of power drags than anything else.
Yeah,
you've got a humpback bridge here. This is, what we get in this part of the world, just kind of rolling roads. It's not as if you need a little ring when you're riding around this part of the world. And Jacob Scott just, raising over there, just easing his legs a little bit. These guys got a tough job. They're not going to give any rope whatsoever. The onus now is left with Jumbo-Visma to control the peloton. Bora did come up. Ineos now sitting second place. But when the gap's like this, nobody's going to give the boys in yellow any help whatsoever.
Nope. Well, they're doing an exceptional job keeping this lead down. Ineos Grenadiers have moved up as they just go over that little humpback bridge. And just on the right-hand side, you can just see the parking area for the ice cream factory. And other ice cream factories are available, but you can pop there, and especially on a summer day like this, and grab some ice cream. Absolutely gorgeous. Again, we are in Cheshire now, but not too far away from the Welsh border, hence the flag. Another man that will know these lanes very well is a man called Steve Lampier. I've already given him a shout today. He was part of the Sigma Sports team back in the day, and this was one of the routes as we headed into North Wales on our deep winter training camps that we used to do as well. So Steve Lampier will definitely know these roads from earlier, a couple of decades ago now. As we look at Olav Koy, what is going to be the plan for Jumbo-Visma today? Will it be just delivering Koy to another victory? Remember, no time bonuses here. But this race, quite potentially, could be decided on countback. So will it be the turn of Wout van Aert to take things up today? A lot could be determined, Brian, by what other teams try and do as well. Jumbo-Visma will clearly have a plan, and given the fact that the climbs we're talking about today are relatively modest, there are hills towards the back end, but they're not going to trouble the vast majority of this field. But if they're ridden particularly aggressively and the intensity is very high, we could see the potential of some splits. But then they've got definitely a plan B. But Olav Koy should be able to get over these climbs okay.
I think everybody will get over the climbs. I don't think we'll have any problems whatsoever. The problem is you're going to have the entire peloton. Okay, it's not a huge peloton in the Tour of Britain, but they will all come into Wrexham. And I've seen some pictures. Obviously, we aren't on site, but I've seen some pictures of the running towards the finish into Wrexham. And I've looked at the race manual. So it's very, very tricky. But like we were saying yesterday in conversation, you have to have a plan A. That's it. You go with that plan. If there's any mishaps or anything, you have to kind of think on your feet. It's not coming from the sports director. It's coming from the riders themselves. So, there could be an opportunity in the last kind of couple of kilometres for the wheel to be let go. But it's down to what they've decided to do themselves. Like you say, with no bonuses, it could come down to, even Wout van Aert still in that kind of second. He's very capable of doing it in the form that he's got at the moment. But what you want to do is guarantee the win. And, that's the important thing. So Olav Koy seems to be the best bet. And Wout van Aert seems quite happy. As long as he picks up, second or third or whatever it is, and these type of tricky conditions to the finish, he's very capable of staying up there and making sure that if it does come down to kind of count back and stage places, that he's picking up some good ones on the way.
Yep, certainly would be the case. Big clutch of fans. That is actually new. That wasn't there when I was riding backwards and forwards. I missed out on that, Brian. I don't even know what that place is. But that wasn't on my commute 20 years ago, or actually 25 years ago. Looks like a lot of fun, though. But you can just see in the distance there, the rolling hills of Peckerton Castle over to the right. Beeston Castle, if you just went around this corner, that little undulation directly in front, and you can just see some of the buildings on the left-hand side. That is Beeston Castle. They don't quite go over it. They take a right this side of it and then head over the gentle undulations which characterise the mid part of this race. Here we go. They're taking that little right turn now. And there's a bit of a kicker coming up in about 2 or 3 K's time, which, again, won't trouble these riders too much. But there, just on the left-hand side, that is Beeston Castle. and Peckerton just over to the right. So the Cheshire Plains are very flat for a pretty big distance. Not too far from Alton Park as well, where there's a lot of racing, and there still is. It's a motor racing circuit, but it's a lot of evening racing there. So Cheshire, and a lot of great cycling country. And there we go, a clearer view of Beeston Castle there. And if you head, if you continue heading that way, you'll ultimately end up in the Peak District as well, another 30 miles or so. But yeah, a great cycling country. It's so lovely to see it showcased so beautifully today. But the gap still only 27 seconds, bright. They are really keeping a lid on this one, aren't they? They're taking no chances whatsoever.
Yeah, I think Jumbo Visma have realised that they're not going to get any help whatsoever. You know, what do you do in this situation? Do you let the gap open to 2 minutes, which tries to entice, you know, others to get involved with the chase, or you just keep it at this pace? So you set the same pace as you would if you're in the breakaway, and that's why, you know, they're just sitting at 30 seconds, and this is the tail of the day.
Indeed. So that little, you can just see the road leading up to Beeston Castle. They're going to go right. There's a little lane up to the left, and that takes you spiralling round. It's a climb I used to a couple of intervals on. You can actually ride right to the very top, in through a gate, and through and in there, and you can even grab a brew. But I didn't go up there very often, but it is absolutely beautiful. And 360-degree views of the beautiful Cheshire Plains. On a good day as well, I'd imagine you can see some of the peaks, some of the mountains of Snowdonia from here as well.
Eight counties, apparently.
There you go. It is absolutely stunning.
And should be a clear day today. I've seen eight counties, and the castle is currently operated by the English Heritage.
Get yourself over there. It is gorgeous. Plenty of parking and lots of walks as well. The two castles that we've just been talking about, Peckerton Castle over to the right and Beeston Castle, which we've just spied, are linked by a long walkway as well. You can actually walk for about 30 or 40 miles right the way through Cheshire. It's an ancient route, and it's I've done a little bit of walking on there in the past. Takes you over this particular range of small hills as Jos van Emden makes sure that he's fully fueled up. They're going to be going through a few beat-ons today in the heat that we've got. And this is the other castle that we were talking about, Peckerton Castle. Not quite in the same state of ruin. You can actually go here and you could have a meal here. There's a restaurant here. There's a hotel at Peckerton Castle as well. You get weddings here. And just off to the left, you can just see that pathway. And many a walk on many a Sunday afternoon. I used to do it back in the day. But 74 k's to go. We're getting some beautiful sights today, Brian.
Yeah, we are. Beeston Castle was 13th century. You know, this is a little bit more modern. It's built in medieval style, 1844, finished in 1850. So a little bit more recent, and that's why it's better nick, as you've just said.
Yeah, look at that. I've never actually seen it from the air before. But absolutely gorgeous. As you say, plenty of parking nearby.
Yeah, originally it was the home of John Tollemansh, a wealthy Cheshire landowner, estate manager and member of parliament. It's now a grade one listed building.
Well, there we go. Full of facts today. And there it is, just from the other side. But really fast roads. A lot of these farm buildings that we've been passing as well, these were all the old dairy farms from back in the day. Many have been converted. But this was one of my favourite playgrounds. That and the Peak District where I used to ride my bike the most. Break of four, still holding steady, only 32 seconds though. It's going to be a very hard day out in front. They're really eating into the mileage today. Super high average speed. Just double check on that one for you. It's going to be well in excess, I think, of 46 k's an hour today. No real surprise, the short stays Van Emden continues to plow on at the front. Yeah, 46.6 kilometres an hour at the moment, approaching half distance very shortly. Scott, Ormiston, Crockett and Stockman doing a great job. Load of club riders out, a lot of Lycra there on the left hand side to cheer on the Tour of Britain bunch. But their lead is a tenuous one. And again, I'm wondering if they'll even stay out front to get the King of the Mountains. That could be an interesting one, but I don't think Bolton Equity's Black Spoke will do any chasing to bring that back, because Jacob Scott is in the move. James Fouché was in the break yesterday. He had a 2 points lead over the man in second place, Zeb Kiffin. So 16 to Fouché, 14 to Zeb Kiffin, and then De Versnies with 11 on the same points as Rukin Gray, and then the next best in fifth, Harry Tanfield, but only 4, 3, 2, and 1 points on offer at the only climb of the day, which does come towards the back end. Although the gap now just going out a little bit to 46 seconds as we get another absolutely stunning view. Beautiful frequency of light here today in the Cheshire Lanes before we loop our way back into Wales. And the, I don't know if you've got that fired up in front of you, Brian. While the race is in this bit of a holding pattern, it's probably worth going through this very tricky approach to the city centre in Wrexham. Now, the riders started on the finish line today, and I'd imagine most of them would have had a good look at the last couple of Ks, because it is particularly technical. One of the most technical finishes we've got, I think, in this year's Tour of Britain.
Definitely, and I think everybody has already looked at it. As you said, we started in Wrexham, and you know, as former managers, you would insist that they go and have a look at it. Okay, not at race pace, but you still have to look at it. That's the difference. Sometimes when you bowl around into town from, you know, the hotel that you're staying in, and most of the riders would have stayed locally and then ridden into the finishing line and or the start place and looked at the finishing line, and you don't always take it at speed. And I think today, definitely, when we get inside that kind of last kilometre, at 900 metres to go, you get traffic lights, you turn right. 300 metres, then you go left again. Another 100 metres, another left. You enter a roundabout with 400 metres to go. It's the first exit. And then with the 200 metres, there's another kind of left-hander. So, and then you get catch sight of the finish. So, and it's not, it's on sometimes the kind of pedestrianised areas and put the kind of bricks down as well. And it's very narrow. It's probably, you know, one car width across, so it's very narrow, tricky, and like you say, Matt's possibly one of the most technical finishes we've got this year.
Yeah, that's the key here. It's not wide open roads. Wrexham is a relatively compact city, one of the smallest cities in the UK, in fact, but the seventh most important city, seventh largest city in Wales.
It's a market town, isn't it?
Yeah, it is a market town, but I'm just looking at the details of it now, and I actually worked here for a few weeks back in the mid-1990s at the Brodge of Marks and Spencer's there, fitting their new loose fruit and veg stands, Brian, back in the day. So I have a little bit of an affinity to Wrexham, spending my lunch hours walking around the town. But yeah, very, very tight corners and very narrow. And given the fact it's not a flat approach, it is a downhill approach, or gradually downhill, means it's going to be super fast, sheltered from the wind as well. But even more important than yesterday, we've seen what Jumbo-Visma can do in terms of the firepower at their disposal. They will take it up, thin things out. But will anybody else try and go long? I'm sure we will see a couple of attacks from the peloton over the top of this this final hill today. But I just think they'll tackle it with so much speed, and the grain is just not enough, that despite one or two riders trying their luck, I do think it will stay together. That's my opinion, as Tom Vertigan just gets a feed from the side of the road there, and at 41 seconds. So the road now just starts to rise for a couple of K. This is a very gentle undulation before we drop back down again. And again, we get another sight of the east side, of Peckerton Castle and the wooded land that surrounds it. It is absolutely gorgeous, especially on a day like this. Today we have been treated to some beautiful shots of a place that has a really fond spot in my heart, that's for sure. So 70 k's to go, Wrexham to Wrexham. Two stages in this year's Tour of Britain. The 19th edition of this race, our place to places. The next one comes quite deep into the race. That's Folkestone to Folkestone, right down in at the far southeast of this country. As the road just starts to narrow a little bit here. I don't know, Brian. I mean, this for me right now is like I was on a training ride. This is all part. It's really quite strange.
Virtual training ride.
Yeah, I'm not. It's been the best part of a decade since I've ridden on these roads. but they are so, so familiar. It's quite a strange feeling. As we see,
Ethan
Vernon. Ooh, that was Vernon there, missing a bottle and missing two. Blimey, what a no! Oh, oh. Three in a row for Vernon
Neil
there.
He's going to be. It's team GB, Neil Poin.
God, blimey.
John Herity, if you're in the team car again listening, he was the first of the staff members there in the pink. John, this is his training roads as well, came from this part of the world. Rode for the Altrincham, you know, racing club. And that kind of that orange and blue. I didn't want to say too much about Altrincham because my local football team's Bromley FC and they beat them 2-1 at the weekend.
All right, Bromley.
Yeah, so I didn't want to kind of rub it in a little bit, but yeah, John Herity involved. His training roads as well round about Cheshire. But you know, they've had a good history of that club. But the boys in pink trying to help out the GB team there and getting it all wrong.
But they've actually got themselves in a pretty decent place there. There's a small lay-by on the right where you can park up, and there's many little footpaths that lead that cut through these fields onto the side of the hill where Peckerton Castle is. So, and it, believe it or not, that was actually slightly uphill, but they're moving at the best part of 40 k's an hour uphill here, and it is quite hard to do a feed at that pace. So Ethan Vernon, unfortunately, he'll get a feed. It's just that when the pace is like this, Bri, through these narrow country lanes, the last thing you want to have to do is drop back and then pace yourself up. I mean, although it's only a short stage, we're probably going to be looking at about 2 hours and 20 minutes of riding time here, taking away the neutral. The last thing you want to do is drop back and then have to pick your way back through these narrow country lanes, because they are very technical, and we've already seen a couple of riders come to grief.
It's just energy that you use to move up, and you don't want to have to do that. Sometimes I would move up when it was like this and there was a small rise and it kind of started to bunch up a little bit. I'd try and kind of move that to move up quickly, because if you're towards the back here, we said it yesterday, when it's snaking like this in one long line, you move up, but who's going to let you in? Not everybody will let you in. You know, everybody's kind of fighting for the space, especially when they're in kind of team order as well. But just looking back there, I never noticed, but you know, obviously Gaviria not wearing mitts, and a few riders don't. You know, I was one of those. But sometimes if your hands are sweaty, and a lot of these bottles are coming out the kind of ice boxes, they're kind of wet. It's not always easy to collect them outside the road, as you say, when they're riding at speed.
No, definitely. That's actually a pretty good point, Brian.
Do you know what the easiest thing to do is? Possibly just put a couple of bottles in a musette, and it's easier to grab the cloth or the handle of the musette and take it that way. And that's why we see a lot of that done in some of the kind of big races. They hand them up in musettes because it's a lot easier to take at a higher tempo, because you know the bottles are wet and your hands are sweaty.
Yep, certainly is the case. As the road just continues to rise ever so gently. Slight little bit of canopy here, offering a brief moment of shade for our four riders out in front. Crockett of St. Piran. Well, there we go, Tom Pidcock. Good bottle take from him there. Out of the saddle. Takes off the gel, which are quite often just attached to the screw lid. That's a good idea. Two for the price of one, but as Brian was saying, yeah, a good method, often employed. Well, when you go through a feed zone, they hardly give bottles. It is just a musette, but on a stage like this, the riders won't be needing really a musette. That's probably one of the reasons. As we head back onto the main road here, there's a couple of steep climbs on this main road, actually, as we head gradually back towards Wrexham. We've just picked up the pace here. This is quite a nice little drag. It dips down, kicks up. But this road heading back towards Wrexham is actually a pretty fast one. And there we go. This is uphill, 41 k's an hour. As they head ever so slightly uphill, the road drops again. They kick over the shoulder of this climb, and then it flattens again before gently undulating on the approach to Wrexham. Still 66.6 k's to go. And a first real study of the Belgian in front. Stockman looks pretty comfortable.
Yeah, they all look comfortable, don't they? It's that kind of poker face. Legs are screaming, but there's not a lot you can do about this. And, you know, they're committed to this. I don't think the gap has gone over much more than kind of 50 seconds. It's been below 50 seconds. Definitely no more than a minute.
Yeah, it's I think it went up slightly, a minute and 10, and then it's come back down. It's been hovering between 30 and 40 seconds. There we go. A slight shaving off of the speed. This is that little kicker that I was talking about before the road drops down again. As we can just see the Isle of Man flag on the left-hand side. Stockman slots back in to position number four, just on the wheel of the 24-year-old Finn Crockett, who looks round. Yeah, I do like the kit of this squad, that is for sure. The bikes really do pop. I think it's fair to say, in terms of colour schemes, the most standout bikes in this peloton of 96 riders, 95 started today. Conversation going on between Wout van Aert there and Affini, Eduardo Affini. A man they've not utilised just yet, but he made a big difference in the closing kilometres yesterday. And when he went to the front, there was riders losing the wheels left, right and centre. Now the saddle though, Jos van Emden. Rodriguez looks okay. The wider just behind Stephen Kreiswijk. It's the American Magnus Sheffield. And there is Wout van Aert just moving up on the outside. Looks pretty comfortable too. All smiles as well from Olav Kooi. So right now, Jumbo-Visma, unsurprisingly, have got things totally in control here, Brian.
They do. They've been lent on. Nobody helping whatsoever. And I think it's a case of yesterday and their dominance. You know, while this gap is, you know, well under a minute, there's no real reason for any team to ride at all. It's more about just looking after the GC contender or the sprinter. The only thing that Jumbo-Visma, if they want help, is to let the gap out, but they're not going to do that. They're sitting in prime position. They've got 1 and 2 in the general classification. You know, they've got that stage win. You know, they've got Wout van Aert right up there in the overall as well, so they're not going to relinquish that. So They knew that the onus would be on them, and you know that they've taken it up, and you know they just have to make sure they manage things. And in this short stage, it's manageable by, you know, a couple of riders on the front, and you know they want to try and win the stage again. But you know other teams will have to think about how they can win.
Indeed. Just trying to listen into the brief conversation there between our moto rider, our moto pilot, should I say, and the man from St. Pirin, Finn Crockett. We got the unusual opportunity yesterday of having a conversation of Harry Tanfield, just who was dropped from the break, giving us a relatively detailed explanation of how bad his legs were feeling, which was quite enjoyable. But they've got a teammate in the break. Well, he's got a teammate in the break today, Adam Stockman, 27 years of age, looking pretty good. And they've got an option for the sprint after a superb performance from David Bomboy on yesterday's stage, finished in 7th place and in what was essentially one long line. I wonder what Sam Bennett can do today as well, another man to conjure with. Was certainly put in a good position by Ryan Mullen. Ryan Mullen really did string things out in the finale. And a good day for Mullen as well. At the end was met by his family. Always lovely for the a lot of the riders who do live in England or in Great Britain to come here and see their families. So a lovely familial atmosphere to this race as well for multiple riders in this field. Although this is going to start to hurt now. Because of the chase behind, these riders can't actually let up at all. If they want to stay out in front, they've got to work particularly hard today, Brian. And we saw the stats of the man in front earlier on, Abram Stockman, having to ride at between 350 400 watts on the front, and for a lot of riders that is that's pretty much threshold these days.
Yeah, they can't hold back. It's not like a kind of transition part of the stage where they can relax in some of the climbs, save that little bit of energy. It's a team time trial. It's you do your effort at the front, swing over, you keep the constant tempo. That's all it is. There's nothing they can do. And also the fact they have to rely on staff members at the side of the road, because with the gap under a minute, their team car won't be allowed to come up and service them. So they'll have to rely on neutral service and getting it from somebody at the side of the road, because, you know, Jumbo-Visma possibly doing this intently so that they aren't getting any support from anybody from the team car.
Yeah, well, they're heading the moment towards Malpas, just gone through Bickerton, way to Hampton Heath. They're heading in a basically a southerly direction now, and the wind will be coming over the left shoulder, and so it's a cross headwind that they're heading into at the moment, but it won't affect the speed too much at all. It is only very light. And as we look at Maiden Castle, again slightly elevated, a castle I must admit that I've not actually visited, but this isn't too far from Malpas, and we're not too far from the border with Shropshire either. That's not too far away at all. So Whitchurch is actually in Shropshire. So we actually head into three counties here today. So No Man's Heath and Malpas are in Shropshire. So we move out of Cheshire into Shropshire and then back into Wales. Let's look at Finn Crockett. Back on the tops, sitting in the slipstream of the man directly in front of him, Callum Ormiston, of the international flavoured Global 6 cycling team. Still moving very nicely, well in excess of 46-47 k's an hour today, as they just lose that little bit of elevation. And a Malpas that they're heading towards, another beautiful market town. One of my favourite cafes was there as well. It was known as Jones's back in the day. Do you know Malpas, Brian? He must have gone through there a few times.
Yeah, but I was one of those riders that never really bothered stopping, Matt, so...
We did stop once. We did a long ride. I remember meeting you and a good friend of ours, Steve Farrell, back in the day. This would have been about 1990. And I rode to meet you at Sandbach, picked you up. Then we rode all the way to the Heights of Abraham down in Matlock. Over the quite a hit, well, an exceptionally hilly route to the Peak District. I know I'd only had a bowl of cereal, so we did actually stop so I could refuel, because I blew big time and still had to ride back over the Peak District with you two. And you're a couple of years older than me, a little bit stronger, and I'd be on the ropes all the way back. I remember it well. Still haunts me that day. So 35 seconds now, still. Jos van Emden sets that tempo in the front. Steven Kruiswijk just sat behind. Imposing sight of Jumbo-Visma in full flight. They are, well, they're the best team in the world at the moment, I think it's fair to say. Winning across the board, leading at the Vuelta as well, leading the Tour of Britain. So much talent packed into this team. And they really are the team that everybody is trying to beat. UAE Team Emirates and Ineos Grenadiers, I think it's fair to say, are the next two teams. But Ineos Grenadiers reconfiguring their team. Just coming to terms with the fact that they've got a big fight up their hands, in relation to winning Grand Tours over the next couple of years. They're having to rethink things. It's just the evolution of our sport is a fascinating one. And dominant teams slipping down ever so slightly, having to reconfigure, reconsider, hire new riders. It's a fascinating time in the sport, isn't it? But the dominant team, everybody knows, is Jumbo-Visma, Brian.
It is, and whether you like it or not, you know, nobody likes domination, but you know, I think everybody was moaning a little bit about Team Sky in the past, and now it's Jumbo-Visma, and it'll be interesting to see what, you know, Lidl Trek do, because, you know, they're the team most active in the rider market in the moment. So let's see what happens, but I really do think that Ineos Grenadiers have to really kind of think about, you know, how they're going to get back and trying to win the Tour de France is, I think, what they are, you know, trying to kind of plan to do.
Yep, I certainly think that's the case. Well, I know that's the case. They've certainly got some enormous young talent in the team, and certain of those riders are in this team that the Tour of Britain as well. Tom Pidcock needs no introduction. Carlos Rodriguez, an enormous talent. And then Luke Rowe, well, one of the most experienced riders in the peloton now, and despite only being 33 years of age. Connor Swift, again, riding at the World Tour level now. This is year two for Connor Swift. Such a likeable character, so strong. A really versatile all-rounder. Magnus Sheffield again, still only 21 years of age. What can that man do? And then Ben Turner, 24. It's a real team of sheer class. But with an eye on the future as well, as our breakaway now continue to look around. And on this particular straight section of road with that little bit of elevation, they're going to be able to see the bunch behind. That's going to be quite demoralizing, Brian, isn't it, as well, despite the best efforts here, still with 60 k's to go. So still about an hour and hour and 10 of racing, give or take, given the speeds that, that we're moving at the moment. This is turning out to be a real slog for them.
Yeah, the Jumbo Visma know that they're not going to get any help. So, you know, why help the breakaway? They're not giving them any time whatsoever. You know, they're keeping them fit, well within their sights. And Stephen Kruijswijk and Joost van Embden, the two riders, two very experienced riders and two big motors that are able to do that. Just a wry smile there by Stephen Kruijswijk. You know, they're not a problem doing this. And in fact, Matt, you know, a lot of people, when you're trying to find some form and, you know, do this in races, it makes you so much stronger. It's, I'm not going to say it's training, but when you're in a team and you're asked to kind of ride on the front, most people think, well, you don't really want to, it's kind of too hard, but it does help your form. If you're one of these kind of motors that rides kilometre after kilometre at the front in these races, it's good training for, you know, your challenges to come later on in the season. So it's Stephen Kruijswijk and Joost van Embden, and fortunately Joost van Embden is in his final year. But he's still a motor himself, you know, rode yesterday, was called up to do a double shift. But the man in second place is retiring next year.
He is indeed, after an amazing career. Just a point of interest on the left-hand side there, or as we look at the screen, that was the International School of Language. Now we are on the outskirts of Malpas, now dropping in to Malpas. Recorded in the Domesday Book. The place actually belonged to a guy called Robert Fitzhugh, the Baron of Malpas. It is an old market town. Right in the centre of Malpas, there's a rather ancient market building. And here we go. A little acceleration through the town. It is a stunning little place, it really is. Proper English, and there we go. The church on the right-hand side. They'll be in and out pretty quickly. It's only small. They actually haven't gone right through the centre. They've just skirted the edge. If they'd have swung left, they'd have dropped down into the town. Probably past Jones's Cafe. But it is an absolutely wonderful place, but it's pretty narrow too. And they're descending now, a long drag. This was another climb I used to timed efforts on, actually, back in the day. It's a false flat for ages, but they're dropping down very quickly. Another very kind toss of a bead on there, and well placed by Joost van Embden to a fan at the side of the road. But yeah, a little smile there. As you pointed out earlier on from Stephen Kruijswijk, they're happy with the situation here. They are having to work hard. But as you say, if no other team's going to do the chasing, they want to make sure they don't leave this dangling out in front.
But on this, you don't want to have Matt, you don't want to take any chance. And I was thinking back to the Giro d'Italia. Was it more 4 or 5 years ago when, you know, we're taking the mickey a little bit about, you know, what they're doing, what the management doing. I think they stopped for a toilet break and Primoz Roglic was, you know, needing service and, you know, but now I think they're totally dialed in to, you know, what they have to do, and they're not making that many mistakes. A few days ago, you know, their attention to detail and what happened to get themselves in the situation they are in the Vuelta was sublime. You know, I was over in Wales at the Ironman Wales in Tenby, and, you know, I was kind of catching up with the stages afterwards at the Vuelta, and I couldn't believe what I was seeing, that, you know, Sepkus had won the stage and where they were all sitting in the general classification. I was like, how did they let that happen? And, you know, they're in a dominant place at the moment, and, you know, they really have kind of stepped up, and even here, they know that they're not going to get any help. They can allow the gap to go up, but if you allow the gap to go up, Matt, then it gives you a harder run in towards the finish, and they had a hard run in towards the finish yesterday, so they don't want to do that again. So what they've decided to do is, no, nobody's going to help us today, we may as well ride ourselves and keep this gap down. And by doing that, it means that these lads that are in front, Scott, Ormston, Crockett and Stockman, they thought getting in the breakaway, they might get bar service, they might get to see their team manager today. Doesn't look like it.
No. Yeah, 33 seconds is the meagre lead. that they've managed to carve out did, as we've mentioned, just go over a minute, but was chipped back very quickly. And for the last 20 or 30 kilometres, it's fluctuated between, well, 25 seconds. It did go down to 22 seconds on that little drag we had as we headed towards the ancient market town of Malpass, which was given market status in 1281. So it is officially an English market town. But they're really moving quickly here. And I think they're going to want to bring this back earlier. I don't think they're going to want to give these lads 34 seconds with 8Ks to go over that final hill. Okay, the final categorised climb is still 19.7Ks to go, but we continue to gain elevation for the best part of 10 kilometres on a moorland just to the edge of Wrexham before plummeting back down in. And I think if I was the DSC, I'd say, right, we want this back before we start that descent in. Otherwise, it gets too technical. And 20 or 30 seconds for these four riders with only 8Ks to go would be too much, because they'll be doing 50, 60 Ks an hour and the run into the line, and not much opportunity to gain any time when the road descends. And what Jumbo-Visma also want to do, Brian, as well as setting up for the win, they don't have to take too many risks. They don't want to leave it and have to push on unfamiliar terrain as well. Now, the Jumbo-Visma guys, of course, will have done their research, but they won't have the local knowledge that a lot of the British lads have got here at all in relation to exactly how these roads are laid out. So I think they're going to want to extinguish any hopes of this break surviving a little bit earlier than they did yesterday.
Because they're not going to get any help, what they're doing is they're forcing the hand of the breakaway. They're making the breakaway ride hard all day. That's what they're doing. By keeping it like this, they're forcing. So we often say the peloton, it dictates the pace of the race. Okay, the breakaway gets in, the breakaway, they are dictating the pace, but ultimately the peloton have got, you know, more times than none, the control of the race. And what they're doing at the moment is forcing. They don't want to be in a situation where yesterday we could see in a lot of the hills early on in mid-stage that they were taking it really easy. Okay, the gap was only a minute and a half, 2 minutes, but that run in towards the line was hard. So what they've decided to do is, you know, force the hand of the breakaway, make sure that they ride hard all day, so that when it comes to the end, Matt, they're not getting any feeds from the team car. They're relying on neutral service or riders outside the road, as we see here. This is harder, so they're not getting maybe some of the stuff that they want, maybe the X in their bottle with some electrolytes or, you know, some energy or whatever it is the different teams take. Most of them are just kind of generally water, so it's tiring them out. It's one of these breakaways where you get in, and we've all been there, Matt. One of these breakaways that you don't get any chance whatsoever to relax at all. It's full on. Yep. It's a team time trial, and that means that they won't have the energy to really kind of try and up it in the end anyway.
No, definitely. Actually, looks like they might have actually pulled out the Shimano car and just dropped in this vehicle here instead, this little moto with the wheels on, because they certainly wouldn't have both. And I think because the gaps are narrow and fluctuating, they've taken out the car so it doesn't act as that little bit of a carrot. And again, this road here is continuing to drop. They're losing elevation all the way at the moment. This section that I talked about, or I used to use it as a section to set a real tempo on, all the way to Malpass. This is very, very fast indeed. They go past a race course soon as well, as we head to a place called Worthenbury. And it's in Worthenbury where we move back across into Wales. Then we head towards a place that we both know very well, Bangor on Dee. And then swing a hard left and head towards a place called Horseman's Green. We're heading back in a southeasterly direction, so a complete change of direction. Heading back towards a place called Whitchurch, so heading back towards Shropshire, and then they'll swing a hard right and then wend their way back towards Wrexham. So at the moment we are heading towards Wrexham, we turn away, head back in, and that's where we'll take in the only categorised climb of the day at Ayton. Again, they've actually been up steeper climbs today, but the Ayton climb is just gradual and long, and no real steep gradients at all, only averages 3 or 4%. But right now, this is a particularly quick bit of road. 50 kilometres to go and a bit more. And it is Stephen Kruiswijk still setting that tempo on the front. And he'll be used to it. This is bread and butter for this. For Kruiswijk and Van Emden, this is basically what they do. They can win races. I mean, Kruiswijk himself, previous leader of the Giro d'Italia, and has been in the top 10 in the Tour de France. But his role now in the team is to do stuff like this, more in the mountains, but he's more than capable of keeping a lid on this breakaway. It's 4v2, but the riders behind are so vastly experienced with that combined Grand Tour experience and the level they ride at. Yep. Nice bit of flair there. Well, 10 out of 10 there for Jacob Scott. A nice bit of a tail whip over the top of that humpback bridge. Oh, yeah. He's having fun, isn't he? I'm glad he landed that okay. That could have been awful, couldn't it? But it's a lovely bit of flair. I'd imagine we'll get a rewind. Let's have a look at this again. Using just the crown of the climb there, goes wide, does a flip, lands it perfectly. 10 out of 10, Jacob Scott, Bolton Equities. There we go. He's having fun, isn't he?
Well, we did say that they've changed the most combative award to the most popular, and I think that could be the moment it decides things for Jacob Scott. I hope it does. You know, good rider, and you know, I think all four of them at the moment deserve it, because you know they've been put on the ropes, you know, quite a lot, purely because Jumbo Visma are not giving them any rope whatsoever. And just going back to what you said there, Matt, that about Stephen Kruiswijk. Yep, he was up there and, you know, the big Grand Tours, leading the Giro d'Italia in the past. And, you know, what you want as a team is to have riders that are very capable of getting up there in Grand Tours to kind of try and help and lead a team in Grand Tours. And, you know, that's what Jumbo-Visma have built. Joost van Emden has gone. He's more of the rider sitting in second place, more of a kind of time trial specialist, kind of multiple champion of the Netherlands, and you know, he's chosen that kind of route for himself. And now, over the last kind of few years, he's been used as a kind of ruler, one of these riders that rides at the front pretty much all day. So it's a totally different way of training as well. We were covering another race. I think it was a Tour of Denmark with Ryan Mullen. Ryan Mullen was a kind of time trial specialist. He's here writing for Bora Hansgrohe, and you know, he was brought up in North Wales. Used to ride for, I think it's the St Asaph Cycling Club, all in that area anyway. So he was kind of brought up in it, not too far away. No surprise that his family were here. But he's now kind of changed to more of a kind of lead out role. And you know, we talk about riders that you don't know, you kind of find your way in cycling as you kind of grow up. What I remember going to ACBB, Matt, and everybody, the manager said to me, you know, what are you best at? And I says, probably, you know, I'm a kind of all-rounder, but I've got a strong sprint. And he kind of looked at me and I went, okay. So then there was a guy there that used to ride for Tekker. He'd gone down to the amateur ranks, and a guy called Philip Laurier. And, you know, he was a rider that was getting up in Vuelta sprints and things like that, and very unique style. And I was trying to kind of help him out and be there in sprints. And then I realised that after the training camp that he was a real sprinter and I was a pretend-to-be sprinter. So I then concentrated on, you know, using that kind of sprint in some of the kind of hillier races, that in a lot of the short, sharp, I had a punch at the top of the hill rather than on the flat. So any kind of uphill finishes, any short, steep climbs, that's what I used to kind of concentrate on. So when you start as a bike rider, you're looking to see what your strengths and weaknesses are. And of course, you want to address your weaknesses and make sure your strengths get stronger and stronger. But, you know, you find your way in a team, and quite often a team is made up of a team. It's just like any other sports team. Like a football team, my boy is playing kind of different positions in a football team. He plays better in some positions and not so good in other positions, and he's finding his way a little bit. And it's a bit like cycling, that you know, you find your way. Not everybody can be a leader, not everybody can take that pressure, not everybody is a Grand Tour contender. We saw this year that that's, you know, people tried. Tom Pidcock was kind of testing himself against the best to see what he could do. Carlos Rodriguez again was up there trying until that crash. I think he showed that he is a GC contender. Until that crash, he was there and thereabouts. It's a bit like what Geraint Thomas did last year at the Tour de France. He went for a podium and got a podium. He realised he's got the intelligence that he wasn't capable of going with the two main protagonists, that he would ride against the rest, and he did that to perfection. What he did there was, you know, really, really intelligent riding. And so it's up to you what you want to do. You have sometimes have to test yourself out. Not everybody's, you know, a great sprinter. Are you a good enough lead-out rider? And, you know, vice versa. So there's a lot of things. It's finding what you're good at and where you are within a team. But all you want in a team, if you're a Grand Tour contender, you go into a Grand Tour, you need riders that are capable of possibly finishing in the top 10 in a Grand Tour. And if you've got three or four of them in a team, then, you know, your quid's in of having riders to be able to help you to win that Grand Tour. And that's what cycling's all about. It's finding that position that you're good at and applying your trade, because it's not all about winning bike races to be a good pro. There's a few riders in here. And we look at, you know, a couple of days ago when Geoffrey Soup, you know, won a stage. He spent his whole career helping other sprints.
Yep.
Amazing to see him win.
Yeah, it was. I was talking of Walter and that win by Geoffrey Soup. I was so chuffed. So chuffed for him. It was, like you say, working in the service of others for many, many years and finally getting that big win. Yeah, that was magnificent. But as you say, you do evolve as a rider, and I think there are more and more opportunities. I think even 10 years ago, 5-10 years ago, there was far more pigeonholing of riders. You're a sprinter, you're a ruler, you're a climber, you're GC. But now, with the advent of new cycling, whatever you want to call it, the cutting edge of cycling now, the way that racing has evolved, the inspiration provided by the likes of Pidcock, Van Aert, and Mathieu van der Poel, and you can also count Tadej Pogacar in there as well. It's this, not so much the multi-discipline stuff, although that's important. It's different, functioning exceptionally well on different sorts of terrains, different styles of racing, whether it's the high mountains, whether it's the Tour of Flanders, whether it's getting involved in sprint stages. It's just, I love the fact that riders that inspire and riders that are important, riders that people want to aspire to be like, are taking risks, trying new things, not pigeonholing themselves as riders, because it's a very short career, unless you're one or two characters have been around for a very, very long time. But it's a relatively short career, and I'd hate for younger riders to end their career and not have tried other areas of the sport. Getting out up the road as well is one thing that's important to do as well, and quite often you might be looking at racing and over time seeing the very low success rate of breakaways, especially in stage races like this, where the break haven't got a big hope of staying away. But imagine if nobody got away and moves. You've got to know what it's like to be at the sharp end of a break. Also, know what it's like to ride, to be in pain for a very long time over different sorts of terrain, whether it's cold, miserable weather, in technical terrain, whether it's in crosswinds, whether it's on climbs. Like you were just saying, Brian, you have to find out about who you are as a rider. And the more you find out, the more satisfaction that you get out of the sport, I think. And we're seeing more and more of that these days as riders are becoming more versatile. I know you mentioned that, you know, riders are almost like robots. Well, I think there's elements of that in terms of discipline. And you could, maybe robot isn't the right word. Maybe just ridiculously disciplined is a better word. But I still see a lot of joy in the sport. And I think this is a wonderful time. Yes, if you want to be the very best, you can be the best. You need to be naturally blessed, of course, but you have to sacrifice a lot. But I still see a lot of joy in the sport. I really, really do. But and the joy of cycling, I think, is expressing yourself and trying new things, like it is in any walk of life, Brian. But yeah, it's and that's why aggressiveness, getting out, and knowing probably that you're going to fail, but doing it anyway, is the only way you really learn, isn't it?
Well, there's two things. I've got two sons, and there's one thing that they're both into sport. They both were introduced to cycling, but they decided to choose the dark side of football and rugby union. And you know, the one word that I always use, and you know, anybody that is introduced to any of my boys, and they can ask them directly, what's the one thing that you have, if you want to be a top sports person, what's the one thing you have to do and concentrate on? And that's discipline. Discipline, 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 all day long. And this is what we're talking about. Yeah, robots maybe not be the right word, it's discipline. You have to be so disciplined in everything that you do, and it's getting, you know, micro nutrition and everything like that. It's not a case of, oh, I'm just going to take a gel now. It's all kind of measured out. You take a gel, you know, every half hour or every 20 minutes. It depends on what you've been told to do. Your nutrition afterwards. Now we've got sleep patterns. Now we've got core sensors. We'll get everything that you need. And nowadays it was trial and error. And, you know, I can remember...
Mostly error.
Yeah. Well, I can remember... You know, back in the day, I was learning. There used to be a book, a coach's book. Eddie B had a coach book that I used to look at. He's more from the kind of Eastern Bloc countries and trying to get to learn things. Listen to your peers, what training do they do, and trying this and trying that. Even when I went to Motorola, even with Phil Anderson and Steve Bauer, I went to with Steve Bauer to do some efforts. I was just asking what you're doing training-wise. I'm going to do this, but I'll come along and try it with you. We're doing hill efforts together. And it's just trial and error. Like you say, that's what we're doing. Then the pulse rate monitors come out, and I used to test myself sometimes to see where my pulse rate was, like not look at it, try and guess. And I was always within about 5 beats. And it's a thing that not everybody knows. You have to know your own body and see what you're capable of. There's no point... If I've coached someone in the past or helped someone in the past, then there's no point easing off in a climb if you're 200 metres from the top and going out the back and having to chase in the descent. If you can just go into the red a little bit and stay with that group, because it's so much easier in that descent to get your breath back. So it's just judging what you can and can't do as a rider as well. But I think a lot of the time it's the discipline off the bike that's the most kind of challenging for most people.
Yeah, I think it is. Yeah, it is a voyage, a perpetual voyage of discovery. Yeah, in every single race situation, you will learn something. Every training ride, you'll learn something. Quite often, it's very subtle. But the thing that I enjoy about racing now, I obviously don't race, but we talk about it for a living. That's what we do. Is the stuff that we could never really explain. The way to pace a climb, for example, was based on feel when we were racing. I'd never hardly even race with a... I did race a bit with a pulse meter, but I'd never really ride to my heart rate. I would just ride on how my body felt. But now, and I look back and I break down some races that I've ridden in the past, and I didn't really know. It was just trial and error, perpetual trial and error. Never really knew how to pace properly, and I think that's one thing that's intriguing now, is the way riders pace time trials, the way they pace climbs, using these multitudes of information that they've got at their disposal, all of their head unit now, and also they can dive even deeper into with their coaches. It's just how to smooth out terrain.
But it's how you use that can have a negative effect as well. See, when you go out, you don't feel too good, and we've all been there, first half hour of a ride, and you're thinking, well, I'm stuck to the road here, and you're looking at your numbers and you think, nah, that's it. You know, after 45 minutes you feel better and you go on and do it. So your body, you have to listen to your body sometimes, and you're right. You can ride, when you lived here, Mark, you could ride round here 5-6 hours every few days and think you're getting fit, and then you go and ride, you know, the tour of Essex, and you know you got these short sharp climbs and you've got everybody else and you're thinking your heart's up and down, and you can ride round here at, you know, 150 160 beats a minute for 6 hours easy, but your heart doesn't do that in the early season races. It's up, it's down, it's up and down, and you think, oh, you know I've been hit with something. But look, I was again away at the weekend. I met some other ex-professionals in a different sport. My boy's into rugby union, and I was talking to some ex Welsh internationalists that were doing the Ironman in Tenby, and you know, I'm trying to, because I've not done that sport. I have at school, but not at that level. So I was trying to give them that little bit of inspiration. So I was just saying, is there anything you can give them? And they said, when you're young, just get your kids to get involved with all sports, because he played number 8 in rugby union, and his weakness was high balls, whenever a high ball came, he struggled to catch it. And he said, get them to play cricket, get them to do multiple sports. It teaches them different disciplines. And then as you get older, you can hone it into one. So that's something that you can do for, you know, kids looking at it. Just don't get them to do cycling, to get them to do multiple sports. He said, that's what he said. He regrets not doing kind of other sports to kind of help them in the early days, because if you're doing high balls when you're 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, then it becomes easy. The older you get, the harder it is to learn new things.
Oh, totally. No, I would only echo that sentiment. If you've got a young person who's looking at getting into any sort of sport, especially whether it's just enjoying it in the first instance, it's just try everything. I mean, when I was a kid, football, cricket, a bit of rugby, not much rugby because I was very, very diminutive. I was a late bloomer, Brian. I was a tiny little fella for a long time. I used to love footy, running, swimming, and I did that, and then finally settled into cycling. And interestingly, I know he's not riding the GB team here, but he's riding with Action next year. Ben Wiggins, chatting to Bradley Wiggins, his dad, a couple of years ago, about not wanting to put any pressure on him riding. He was clearly very, very strong, but he was playing rugby, playing football. And this is just 2 years ago, and now he's world champion. You know, it's just about enjoying sport, not putting any pressure, guiding them, giving them choices. And obviously, when you're somebody that's done particularly well in the sport, part of you is going to want them to do it, but also part of you is going to be quite protective. And ultimately, there's got to be a joy in it. But I do agree, that multifaceted approach. For youngsters before they finally settle down into something that they love, that they truly love and enjoy, and also giving them that choice as well so they've got ownership of something is massively important. I know we've got on a slight podcasty tangent, mate, but it's all these aspects are what makes elite athletes, and cycling is no exception at all. We live in, I think, a bit of a golden era of bike racing. And we look at the kind of champions that we've got in the sport. And I remember a few years ago when high-profile riders started to retire, and you thought, well, who's going to replace them? But year on year, Brian, we've got riders on this conveyor belt coming through and entertaining us. It's a fantastic time. It really, really is. And some of the best riders of the world have been showcased here on home roads in the Tour of Britain. So if you just joined us, me and Brian have been doing a kind of broad cycling podcast for the last 10Ks or so. But this is stage two of the Tour of Britain. It's the shortest stage of this year's race, 109.9Ks. We start in Wrexham and we're finishing in Wrexham. A big loop out into the Cheshire Lanes. A little bit of a trip into the lanes of Shropshire too. And now we're going to be heading back into Wales very, very shortly. But our breakaway of the day has only enjoyed a slender lead for the entire time they've led this race. And the composition of the move. The man in front is Callum Ormiston of South Africa, riding for the Global 6 team. Just behind him is Finn Crockett of St Pirin. Also in the mix, in the blue jersey there of the TDT Univet cycling team, is the Belgian Abram Stockman. And the man at the back, who's been entertained us today, a little bunny hop tail whip about 10Ks ago, is Jacob Scott, twice the King of the Mountains in previous editions of the Tour of Britain. But the lead is still only 35 seconds. And we're going to be heading into some more undulating terrain. We've got a climb coming up at 19.7Ks to go. But right now, it is pretty much as you were, Brian, isn't it? This is a lid firmly kept on this breakaway, which is also, I think it's fair to say, it's a mark of respect, isn't it, that they're not allowing them this lead? Because there is clear respect. Smaller teams out in the front here, but the World Tour teams, in chasing and holding them at bay, is because we can't afford to let these guys get too far in front.
If this was a longer stage, it would be a kind of different pattern. But after yesterday, Jumbo-Visma don't want to make it hard on themselves. And so far, they've only used two riders and they've kept it 30 seconds. You know, they know that, you know, when they do that, it's an easier task for them. They can ride a lot steadier. It's not as you know, like the start, we never saw everybody kind of stopping for natural breaks, allowing them to get 2 minutes and then ride tempo. And that means in the last kind of 50, 60 kilometres, you have to bring back 2 minutes. Well, now they only have to bring it back 30-odd seconds, which is a lot easier. And Joost van Emden and Steven Kruiswijk can just swap turns, keep it at you know, a certain level and, you know, hold the breakaway. And some may ask, four against two, surely the four riders in front can pull that out. We mentioned the other day, these guys race at probably 1 or 2 kilometres an hour more than the guys at the front. And that's the difference in levels between first, second and third category. Third category teams aren't allowed to ride at World Tour races. And the World Tour races are so much faster. If you've seen even the Mark Cavendish documentary on Netflix, he says it's the Tour de France, even in the last kind of decade, has got faster and faster. So when you're used to riding at these sort of levels, you can ride, you know, you can train and ride at these levels all day long. It's okay for some of the kind of second division teams, they can get a chance to do some higher level races. But all these riders that we're seeing at the moment, second and third division teams, you know, they're averaging and their race averages are a little bit slower than they are at World Tour. So that's why two World Tour high class cyclists in Steven Kruiswijk and Joost van Emden can hold four riders at 30 seconds, just the two of them themselves.
Yep. Bottom line is, they are very, very conditioned, very, very strong. Ridiculous muscle memory has been at the height of their powers as well. Both of the riders in the front have been doing it for a very, very long time. It's sad to see Joost van Emden leave the pro peloton, but 38 years of age, former national champion, a couple of times I think he's the national champion of the Netherlands at the time trial, took a stage of the Giro, final stage of the Giro, a few years back as well in Milan, and his medals at the World Championship level too. Van Emden, a very well-respected rider. Close look at some refuelling being done for the TDT Unibet cycling team rider Abraham Stockman. Another ripple of applause from the crowd at the side of the road, enjoying the sunshine here. And another wide manoeuvre there from Jacob Scott. You can tell, I mean, clearly this is going to be hurting every time he hits the front there, but he is having a little bit of fun there. He also knows, given the time gap, and it's I don't know whether that's accurate, it is actually going down to 20 seconds or so, but I don't think Jumbo Visma will want to bring this back just yet. They almost brought it back on a long drag earlier just outside Malpass, and it's
on
the climb.
I don't think they care as long as Steven Kruiswijk and Joost van Emden can set a tempo hard enough and they can do that in the last 34 kilometres, then that's what they'll do. They're not caring about this breakaway. What they're doing is they're setting their tempo. If they collect this breakaway soon or later, they don't really care. They're just keeping it at 30 seconds, and, you know, that's all they're concentrating on. So they'll be riding at a level that they know that they can ride at this level in, you know, for the next 34 kilometres. That's all they're thinking about at the moment. It's kind of lined out a little bit more at the front. At the back, it's kind of bunching up, but I think this is going to be a case of into that last kilometre, Matt, and let's see. It's very, very technical. We mentioned it right from the start. It could be a case of Wout van Aert and Olaf Kooi. How do you beat that? That's the question.
Oh, yeah. You've got to ride. You've got to anticipate. It's the buzzword of the last couple of years, particularly the last couple of seasons. Especially at World Tour level, is trying to, you've got this, some of the best riders in the world, pound for pound, on any bit of road are going to beat them. They're just stronger. So what do you do? How do you cope with that? And that's when you look at the details. That's when you get down and look at things at granular level. And that's when you, the only way to beat, or to try and beat riders, is to do things you wouldn't ordinarily do, is to try an unorthodox approach. As we get another look at the right hand of Fernando Gaviria. You can see his left hand is on the hood there. And clearly, we can't see it, but it's his palm that is causing him some problems. And he's out of the way there as well. He's just riding at the back there because he's not going to be able to react quite the same. He'll have his brakes the continental way, so luckily you'll be able to brake with the front, which is the brake that you use a little bit more on a bike. You generally feather the back brake, but he's definitely holding that hand slightly differently to the front one, so I don't think we'll see Fernando Gaviria participating in the sprint today, Brian, that is for sure.
But just to go back, like it.
Yeah, just to go back to the point that we were talking about, it really is a fascinating one. So what would you say, okay, Brian, we talk about disruption and anticipating. Right now, who's dictating the pace? Is it Jumbo Visma? Because they're riding at a certain speed, is that forcing the group in front to ride at that speed and react to it? Or are these guys dictating the pace and Jumbo Visma just holding it behind them? Because they're two different things, aren't they? And because this race is so short today, the dynamics are a little bit different than normal.
Jumbo Visma dictating the pace of the race today. Joost van Emden and Steven Kruiswijk are riding their tempo. They would rather keep them at, you know, around about 30 seconds and not catch them, as you've already mentioned, because then, you know, everybody else starts to get excited. But it's forcing the hand of the group in front. They cannot ease off. If they want to remain in the breakaway, they have to start pushing on. And that means they start to get fatigued. And if they get fatigued, we don't get a scenario which we had yesterday where they're a little bit harder to be brought back. So it's Jumbo Visma are well in control of this. You know, looking at Fernando Gaviria's hand again, but my only input would be in the last few corners, and if I can just pull this up again, I think we go into the last kilometre and then at 900 metres to go at the traffic lights, we turn right. So with 1 kilometre to go, all I would say, and you've got around about 2 kilometres to go, you've got three central islands. So that's going to be tricky. So I would say 2 kilometres to go, which is still far out, I think you really have to be trying to kind of take this on from the front. Ideally, at that corner, right-hand corner with 900 metres to go, ideally you could do with 2 riders in front of your sprinter. Right? If you go into that phase of left, right to the finish, then you stand a chance. If Jumbo Visma go round that corner first, then it could be game over like yesterday. It'd just be so fast. So if Affini goes into that corner with Wout van Aert and Olaf Kooi, I think it could be game over again. They might use that tactic of just let the wheel go. We'll have to kind of wait and see. But they want to guarantee the win. So if I was in one of the team cars behind and I had 2 strong lead-out riders and a good sprinter, I'd say to him, that's crucial. Inside the last kilometre, that right-hand turn, if we're at the front with 2 riders, then we're in with a chance.
Yep. It is both of the bends within the last K. Within the last 800 metres, 750 metres, you've got, as you said, under Flam Rouge, hard right. And it isn't a 90-degree bend, it's like a 100 degrees, so it's nasty. It's slightly back on itself, and then you've got another one, so only 200 metres after that right-hand turn, there's left, and then there's a little chicane before
narrow.
The finish opens up, yeah, and it is very, very narrow. So it's going to be one rider. It was one rider around the corner yesterday, and we had a very wide, open finish, but this is going to be different. Narrow streets of Wrexham City Centre used for the finale today. They've already seen it, so the riders, as we were talking about earlier on, will have had sight of it, and you've not got the opportunity to ride it at race speed, but they'll know exactly what they're coming up against. But just back to the point that we were talking about that led us into this conversation, Brian, is what can other teams do? Because it's all right, and it's a commentator's cliche, timing is crucial, timing is crucial. But it's not just timing. You need riders who have the physiological capacity to ride for like 1,000 watts for 30 seconds to get riders into those sorts of positions, and not everybody has that. So it's not just about timing. And we heard from Ethan Vernon yesterday, he said he hoped that lads be a bit better, they just couldn't, he didn't have the support, so he just was locked into 8th position or whatever, managed to move up to 5th in the final because he's so fast. But what Jumbo Visma have, despite using 2 riders now, they've got another couple of riders that are just pound for pound stronger than anybody else's lead out, so they dominate it. So then you have to anticipate even further. Do you try and take a risk on a descent to open up a 10 second lead with somebody? These are the sort, so we're getting further and further away from the finish in terms of trying to get clear. But if it's just pound for pound tackling Jumbo Visma, there's unforced errors, them getting it wrong tactically or crashing, or let's hope that doesn't happen. But otherwise, you really need to look a little bit differently in things and be willing to take a risk, and not so much a technical risk, taking it too hot into a corner. I mean actually willing to lose and doing something very, very unusual on the approach. And that's easier said than done, though, isn't it?
see the speed they were riding at yesterday, and they were riding at speeds. It was one line, and we were just like, wow. If you have to move up, it's going to be very difficult to be able to do that. So the thing I said yesterday, not everybody did it, and I thought Movistar would have tried to do it. See, if you just put a rider up, that gives you the right to ride at the front, so that a team will let your teammates in. What they didn't do, because they didn't put anybody in the lead, there was only three teams riding. There was Ineos, Jumbo-Visma and Bora. So, you know, if you're talking about three teams in front, that's 18 riders that are right up there towards the front. And then you're further back. And if you're further back and into that kind of final phase, I know that not all the teams had numbers up there, so you cut it down. But if you're going to... That's the thing, is GB, if they put a rider up to kind of help the chase and things like that, GB can ride nearer to the front when we start to get into the most technical part of it. What they were trying to do is bring Ethan Vernon up and try and keep him up there. When they're riding at 50-odd kilometres an hour at the front, that means that rider bringing that Ethan Vernon up, he's having to ride close to 60 kilometres there to get him up there and then keep him there. Because as you say, they won't let GB or anything like that into the chain of another team. You know, that's your wheel, so you'll stay. So the riders have to ride in the wind. And you can't think about it with 3 kilometres to go. You have to think about it 10 kilometres to go. I know it's a small group and everybody thinks, oh, I'll easily, you know, move up. It's okay riding in the peloton behind, but when it's strung out and as fast as it was yesterday, you've got to remember, Mark, and you mentioned that afterwards, the road into Manchester could have been a little bit more difficult than it was yesterday. It was in dual carriageway. There's plenty of space. It's the fact that you need the firepower. When there's plenty of space, you have to have the firepower to do the same speed as the guys that are riding on the front to look after your sprinter. And Ethan Vernon went into that last phase in fifth place and finished in fifth. So a lesson learned from that. Go into that phase in a better position and then you give yourself a better chance, because yesterday was fast enough and hard enough. Today is even more technical, and I think going into that right hand corner, depending on where you are, will determine where you'll finish in the stage.
Yep. And do you even think, Brian, I mean, again, I was nowhere near a sprinter, but just I do enjoy the science, the art of the sprint and what Rod's have to do now, especially on technical runnings. But do you think somebody like Vernon, because he is, I mean, he has won World Tour race this year, you know, and last year, he's a classy rider. He's got a young team around him that are willing, but not quite at the same level, understandably, as the lads at Jumbo-Visma. But do you think even making an effort yourself a little bit earlier to get yourself into a position, then go again? I mean, when you look at what Ethan Vernon is very capable of, he wins prologues, he wins on the track. It's almost like a points race sort of effort, is to just go a little bit early, to invest rather than relying on being placed there. Do you think he's got the capacity to do something like that?
Yes, a good point, Matt, because that's what happens in racing in Belgium. I always say to people, if you go into a climb in 20th, 30th position, you've tried to move up, you've got that position, and you say to yourself, could you have made a little bit more effort to move up into the top 20, top 15? That means that after the climb, it makes it so much easier. But you're thinking, oh, I don't want to make that hard effort because I've got to make an effort on the climb. But what happens is, when you do make that hard effort, right, you get rewarded afterwards, after the climb, because you're not having to close the gaps over the top of the climb. And that's how these races work. It's the people that are willing to make that little bit more extra effort, get in that top 10, then they come on to the first part, the narrow road to the climb, they ease off, you get your breath back, and then you race over the top. But it's in single file. And if you're 30th position, you can imagine putting 30 bikes in front of you, that's the difference. And if somebody cracks or anything like that, you have to open the gap. So if you're in the top 10, it's a lot easier. So again, today, this type of finish, as you've already mentioned, if he's team can't do it, then he has to position himself. I think a little bit like Sam Bennett did. He was brought up, he chose Olaf Coy's the wheel, and I believe that Olaf Coy's the wheel today, but Sam Bennett didn't have the legs to accelerate. He sat down. As soon as Olaf Coy opened up, he sat down. He just didn't have the legs yesterday. But someone else might have the legs, and I noticed that Ethan Vernon, he was further back, having to close gaps. even when he came round a corner. When you come around a corner 300 metres to go, you could see that straight away, came round a corner, Wout van Aert was straight up to speed. And if you're five bike bends back, you're just coming out the corner. You've no chance at 300 metres. So
yeah, totally.
this one especially, my advice would be that right-hand turn at 900 metres to go, make sure that you're up there, top three, ideally with a teammate with you to be able to help you. You have to be on the front foot in this one.
Yeah, and it's also worth noting, this sort of finish, this sort of field is different than the field at the Tour de France, that there's a different sort of sprint. You haven't got six or seven top-tier sprinters, all with very capable lead-out trains, where it becomes a completely different discussion. This is particular to this race here, and what teams can do here. It is fascinating, and I could talk ad infinitum about it. But from sprinting to the approach to the only categorised climb of the day, we're heading now in a north-westerly direction, rapidly approaching the bottom of the only categorised climb of the day, the gap to our four riders out in front. As we descend over the bridge and the road starts to gradually climb, and I do seem to remember this little climb being in the Milk Race many, many, many years ago. We're talking about in the early 90s when both of us were riding, Brian. But anyway, that's for another day. 17 seconds, but the top of this climb comes at 19.7 seconds. It won't be long before we actually hit the slopes of the climb of Aiton. It's third category, 1.97 kilometres in length, but only averaging 2.7 k's. They're going to be moving at this. Well, it's just a long drag, and the gap is starting to close. I'm wondering if Jumbo-Visma, Brian, will want to actually shut this down on the climb and control things over the top. But saying that, even 16 seconds over the top of this series of ridges that we're approaching should be enough for them to bring it back. But I have a feeling that they might want to bring it back on the climb by the looks of things.
I think Jumbo-Visma are just in lead-out mode. They've started to control things. You know, that's what they're trying to do now. They're doing what they have to do. They've got three riders at the front. And it's up to the breakaway. This 18 climb is not that difficult. You know, it's on this road, 4-3-2-1. I'm pretty sure that's because of the sponsor of this King of the Hills competition, that it just so happens that the Bolton team are riding those particular bikes. And I would think that Jacob Scott would, the fact that Fush is winning that competition, he'll want to take maximum points, possibly thinking of later on the race having two options for that team. But you know, the guys at the front here for Jumbo-Visma, they're just thinking one thing only, and that's just riding and controlling the peloton and making sure that they ride hard enough up this climb, Matt. If they do bring this breakaway back, then so be it, but it's riding hard enough up this climb just to thwart any type of any kind of counter move.
Yep. Looks like they're going to be doing a left in a minute, just looking at their direction of travel. They swing off this main road and left, and then they'll commence the climb up to Aiton. And that's a good point, actually. I'm omitted to discuss or mention the point that Bolton Equity's bikes are Pinarello's, and the black jersey on the shoulders of King of Mountains leader James Fouché, of course, carries that name. So, yeah, of extra importance here. But the gap's holding steady at 14 seconds. Come down a bit. The approach to the climb is gradually uphill as well. There is our race leader, yellow helmet in that blue and red kit, and just in front of him in the green jersey, keeping it warm for his teammate from the Netherlands, is Wout van Aert. Just a reminder of who's wearing the other jersey in this race. I've just mentioned James Fouché in the black jersey of King of Mountains leader, and the white jersey is Stijn Fredheim, who finished up in the sprint yesterday. And rides for Uno X. This is this left turn coming up, and that would take us on to the bottom of the climb. 18 seconds is the gap as they swing left here, Brian.
Yeah, I was just thinking as well, just as we're coming up to the top of this climb, and you know, if they want to take it on, there's no reason why GB can't come to the front with 3 kilometres to go with the whole team and then decide to kind of take it on themselves. I think that would be a good thing to do. The last thing you want to do is come into the last 2 kilometres, and this is the case where you've got the whole team of Jumbo-Visma are setting tempo, and you're wanting to sit behind them. I think I really do think it's a case of we'll take it on from the front. And I mentioned it yesterday again, a team that I used to involve with in the Tour of Britain, and that's what we decided to do. Don't leave up to Team Sky to dictate the tempo. You take it on and you put yourself in the front foot. So I think any team that wants to try and win and beat Jumbo Visma, they have to take it on in front of them and not from behind them.
Yep. I think that's definitely going to be the case. Will there be a team that's willing to do that as we hit the bottom of the climb? The Pinarello King of the Mountains. Cat 3 today, 8 and 4 points on offer for the first man across the line. Then 3, 2 and 1. First four score. Leader of that competition. And cannot be challenged unless the man in second place in the King of the Mountains decides to clip off the front and take the win, and that is Zeb Kiffin. I can't see that happening, to be perfectly honest with you, as they continue to rise up. 11 seconds it's saying. I think it might be just a little bit more than that. And the man on the front now, Abraham Stockman. But there's no descent off this climb. It's a slight little drag downwards before they kick up again to the intermediate sprints. That comes at 15.3k's to go. It's essentially a set of steps. There's then a 2 or 3k drag down, then another long drag, which is longer than this climb, before the gradual drop down into the finish at Wrexham. So we've got the next 6 or 7 kilometres, primarily, more than that, about it's the next 10k's are primarily uphill in a series of steps. So tough terrain, not super steep, no real change in the shape of the bunch here, but it is, interestingly, Keep Kern Farmer now, who are moving to the front on the left-hand side. They've got a very good rider amongst their number. That's Roger Adlia, who's actually moving across to Bora Hansgrohe for the next couple of seasons, Rob.
Yeah, very good rider. That's a team in the kind of petrol green colour, more of that kind of petrol green than there is in Bora Hansgrohe, but yeah, it looks as if they're going to kind of hang on a little bit.
I tell you what, it's James Fouché who's launched himself out of the bunch. Well, great move here. He can sense that the break is coming back, so Fouché wants to score a few more points. He's been uncontested here. So he's leapt clear, bridging across the gap now. So quite clearly, the man who won't do any more riding for the time being in this group is Jacob Scott. He's looking around, waiting to see. He'll imagine he would know what is happening, but so it's Ben Crockett now taking things up the road. Yeah, it's going to be close. Oh, there you go, Crockett. Ooh, Fouché just gets a point there. So good riding there by the man from Black Spoke.
Yeah, in hindsight, I know that Jacob Scott saw that was happening. In hindsight, maybe easing up a lot more and allowing Fouché to take another 1 point, yeah. Finish in third place. But that's all in hindsight. I think it's a good idea that, Jacob Scott had taken possibly maybe maximum points, so he's maybe caught in two minds there what to do.
Yeah.
It seemed like that way because, you can't get, Fouché to get in another breakaway. Well, it's Jacob Scott, we know, that can get in another breakaway and take some more points, and you have two riders up there in the King of the Hills competition. That's probably the best bet, but good effort there from Fouché, taking 1 point to add to his tally.
Yep, that moves him into 17 points. He'll be back on the podium. Mathematical chance that he could have lost that lead today if Zeb Kiffin had beaten him and he hadn't scored, but that didn't happen. He took a solitary point. And the rider that's dropping away from the front of the group is Jacob Scott. So Jacob Scott also dropping back now, leaving two riders out in front. Finn Crockett of St Piran leading Abraham Stockman of the TDT Unibet cycling team. And as you can see, the gap has come down to around about 8 seconds, but the road continues to rise. There was a brief little downhill, but the road's now continuing to rise in a series of steps. And it won't be very long, in fact, just a couple of kilometres before we pass through the only intermediate sprint of the day. No time bonuses, as we've stated on regular occasions in this year's Tour of Britain, but there are points towards the green jersey classification. In fact, the sprint rewards the first five riders across the line, 10, 7, 5, 3 and 1 points on offer in about 2.5k's time. But unsurprisingly, Brian, these two riders still continuing on, which has been the theme of these breaks. Towards the end of the break, as it starts to capitulate, there's always a couple of riders that want to take things up and continue.
Yeah, possibly not the best day to get in the break, the way that things have gone today. But you always think that you know, before the stage, short stage, you know, I can keep a high tempo for these couple of hours of racing, and, you know, entice these riders to be able to do that. But the way the Jumbo-Visma have ridden today, they've just kind of pretty much blocked it off, that no one's getting any rope whatsoever. We're going to keep it very, very short. We're going to control this race. We're going to show our strengths. Very few riders helped us yesterday. Never get any help whatsoever today, but you can see some more colours coming up towards the front of the peloton now. There's a few more teams trying to get a little bit more excited, as you would. You come into the last kind of 20 kilometres, you see the boards ticking down, you know, 20, 15, 10, and I'm sure that the team manager's just given the last kind of orders of what they want, whether they're watching us or whether they're watching it somewhere else. But I really do think that, you know, a couple of teams will take the fight to Jumbo-Visma, but it's going to be a tough one because they look as if they're totally kind of dialed into what they need to do today.
Yeah, definitely. And that's the thing, isn't it? When you've got a team that's so relatively dominant, it's got some great teams here, Movistar, Ineos Grenadiers, you know, Bora Hansgrohe. We do have some big, big teams here with strong riders, but we're very early in this race. But what other teams have got to be careful of, and I'm sure their direct sportifs, road captains are fully aware, is that they don't let Jumbo-Visma strangle the life out of this race as well. You've got to just ride your own race as well and not be intimidated by Jumbo-Visma. They're a team that have earned a great deal of respect, but also shouldn't be afraid of trying to get up the road and trying to disrupt without, of course, wanting to embarrass yourself, because they are so strong. But other teams now moving up. Uno X are moving up on the inside there. The team in that primarily red kit now, so red and yellow kit, also moving up. We saw Equipe Kern Farmer as well, also prominent in that dark navy blue with the light blue stripes, just on the left-hand side of the road there, right, as we approach the sprint. That sprint came very, very close. It's only about 300 or 400 metres away. If I can just steady and just read that sign, that we're coming through that intermediate sprint very, very quickly. Now, although we are climbing, it's not particularly steep at all. Again, a road I know very, very well. It looks like this is going to be uncontested, to be perfectly honest with you. And a couple of rude smiles from our two leaders, Stockman and Crockett here. They know that their fate is in the hands of others now, isn't it? That they can ride as hard as they can, but it just depends on what happens behind here. So the field just fanned past that park car. Sprint finish has been taken. Stockman taking that one. Uncontested, Finn Crockett finishing in second place. Haven't quite seen what the situation was behind. Again, there was no real sprint for the final points there in the green jersey classification. A blanket finish. If they've got a camera there, because that might be difficult to pick the bones out of that one, Brian, if you're doing it manually.
But yeah, but there we go. I said it yesterday. I think possibly organisers have got that wrong in the sprint. You know, no bonuses, nobody racing for it, because you would have had a bit of a race there for the last second, and, you know, that wasn't the case. So just, you know, riding over that point, no real sprint at all. We saw it yesterday, it wasn't really contested. So maybe they might look at it and change it for the future, but I don't think for me in the first two stages it's going to really work for them.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. Maybe keep time bonuses, but again, we'll find out. I think we'll be best position to consider the absence of the time bonuses in this edition of the Tour de France, as we look at the Brother UK factory, a big sponsor of cycling in Britain over the years, an important location, looking at regeneration and recycling these days. So we'll just go through Johnstown, which is named after John Bury. The side of that sprint, but so yeah, Brother UK, massively important sponsor, and I've been involved in supporting cycling in Great Britain for many and many years now, but they still haven't been caught. So fair play to Finn Crockett of St Piran now, continuing his effort. Slight downhill section here for about a k and a half, and then we get onto another long drag again, about 2 or 3%, but it does continue over this hillside before we then drop down the other side into Wrexham. So we've got the best part of 5 or 6 k's primarily uphill as we look at confirmation of the only climb of the day, won by Finn Crockett ahead of Jacob Scott, Abram Stockman and James Fouché, the leader in that classification, taking 1 point to bring him up to 17 and in fact extend his lead in the King of the Mountains / King of the Hills. So DSM on the left hand side road, moving up. Movistar also there as well. So a lot of teams very wary of these last few Ks, especially given the fact they've got to climb and then that running down to the line. So I can't see the breakaway staying much longer in front, Brian. And this is more the momentum of positioning now than anything else, than an absolute definitive chase.
Yeah, it's more about staying at the front, and you know that pushes up the tempo. Yus van Emden has done his job and now at the back. So not too worried about the breakaway riders. Be interesting to see who wins the most popular rider of the breakaway award. I would give it to Finn Crockett, winning the King of the Mountains, finishing second there, and I think one of the kind of instigators of this breakaway. So it's game over for them as the peloton start to push for their position in this peloton.
Indeed, we did actually pass by, just to give them a bit of a nod. That was the Brother UK Recycling Technology Centre, and we're just in Brabant now. And it's a state-of-the-art recycling facility, certified carbon zero by the Carbon Trust. So big shout out to Brother UK there as the peloton take back the final two survivors of the breakaway. So a big doff of the cap to Finn Crockett of St Pirin and indeed Abram Stockman. As we look at the back of the peloton, they're moving very quickly, and a team we've not mentioned too much today in the centre now, Trinity Racing, in that brand
this is what
new
I'm saying,
kit
Matt,
for this race.
Keep going from the front. It's a little bit too far out, 12 kilometres. I know that you give out the orders, this is what you want to do. Don't allow Jumbo-Visma just to dictate things. You take it on from the front, but it's still 12 kilometres to go, so it's still a way out. Put them in a good position, but have numbers, like Movistar have numbers to the left-hand side. It looks like they're going with Serrano. And right-hand side, you've got Uno X in the red, but GB of the middle there. But this is what you want to do, but you want to do it a little bit closer to the finish, because you will burn some teammates out if you do that.
Yeah, you certainly will. So one on the right-hand side, as we look at it, well, it was Uno X, and now it is Bora Hansgrohe taking things up at the top. Just a little bit of a look round there from that's Ryan Mullen. Spread across the other side of the road, we've got in two distinct parts there, the Movistar team. Max Canterbury, their protected sprinter, but watch out as well for last year's winner, Gonzalo Serrano, finished ninth yesterday. He's got a very fast finish in the centre as well for the first time today. After Jumbo-Visma have been setting the tempo, is the all-white of the Great Britain team as they head into the lanes now. This is where the road will drag up for the best part of 2 or 3Ks now. Again, moving very quickly. It certainly isn't a climb with any steep gradients in it. More a long, long drag, but there is elevation, and it's Great Britain, the only national team in this race that have taken things up at the front. And also Movistar there on the right-hand side. That's all a little bit of local knowledge there from the Great Britain team, because the road did narrow significantly there, Brian.
Yeah, it did. But, you know, good to see some of the teams that have come up. You see Wolf van Aert just kind of looking after himself. His teammates are still round about them. And, you know, they're not riding as fast as they were just a moment ago. It's a case of, right, we've got you in position now. We're just going to try and keep you there. I think GB have got themselves in a bit better position than they had yesterday. They've eased back a little bit because they know that the last few kilometres are going to be so fast, because they know that everybody will be wanting to get into those last kind of 2 kilometres as far to the front as possible. So it's not kind of lined out like it was yesterday. So this is a chance just to make sure that you get your breath, you keep concentrating, and you stay in position.
It's quite difficult to stay in position here on these slightly narrow roads. You've just got Ineos Grenadiers moving through the centre. Oops. Ben Turner, you can see that little pinch point there. A couple of riders just gesturing with their hands that the car's on the right. This is a stressful time here. These traffic calming devices aren't just, of course, here in England. They're all over, well, Wales, should I say. They're all over the world now, and these riders are used to them. But they can be quite stressful nonetheless. Moving now through to the front is Magnus Sheffield, the American. 10 kilometres to go now on at stage 2 of the Tour of Britain. We had a breakaway of 4. They never got too much of a lead. They were held at bay by the force of Jumbo-Visma. Two riders sat on the front for that squad, Jos van Emden and Steven Kruiswijk, meaning that Jacob Scott of Bolton Equities Callum Ormiston of Global 6 Cycling, Abraham Stockman of TDT Unibet Cycling Team, and Finn Crockett of St Pirin never got too much of a lead. It was Finn Crockett that took the points on the only King of the Mountains of the day. And the only sprint of the day towards the green jersey went to Abraham Stockman. But it is all back together now. We've got a couple more kilometres of climbing. And that was quite interesting. That was a quite an aggressive little gesture there by Nathan van Hooydonk. Pretty unhappy with a certain situation there. I think he's having a word with Magnus Sheffield there, Brian. Just shows that there's a real bit of tension, isn't there? This is quite stressful now.
Yeah, it's other teams getting involved. They've every right to do what they want. You know, road space is road space, and, you know, it's at a premium at the moment. But, you know, the pace is not on, Matt, and that means that, you know, there's a lot of bunching up, a lot kind of pushing and shoving. Jumbo-Visma have had it pretty easy today. They've used two riders. Now, you can see that they've been kind of pushed back. They've been challenged for the front by many others. Finnish Grenadiers on the left-hand side and the reds. Movistar over on the right-hand side. Still, Bolton Equities in the purple, trying to look after Townsend. GB in the middle there as well, getting involved with the mix. So there's a lot of teams wanting to gain position. I don't think it's necessarily crucial that you're on the front now with just under 9 kilometres to go. I think it's a balancing act of keeping position and not wasting too much energy.
It certainly is, but these last 8.7 kilometres and counting are going to go by very, very quickly indeed. Movistar just wind it up on the right-hand side. Nathan van Hooydonk on the left-hand side. The man just at the back there, Steven Kruiswijk. Well, his job is done today. You never know, he might make one more reappearance at the front, but I think the intensity that he's been riding at for the vast majority of the day today on this very short stage, 109.9 kilometres, a big loop around out of Wales into Cheshire, briefly into Shropshire, back into Wales to finish in the city of Wrexham. And again, the road narrowing here, stressful run into the line here, and soon we're going to start to lose elevation rather than gain it. And I think we're at that point now as Magnus Sheffield of Ineos Grenadiers takes the front, Brian.
Yeah, it's getting very tricky and narrow. And this is the way in towards the finish as well, as we know. And it gets even trickier as we get into the last couple of kilometres. Plenty of road furniture, so you have to be really, really attentive. And a lot of riders have obviously done the homework, possibly ridden in the last few kilometres into the stage this morning, so they'll know what they're up against. But again, it's a case of keeping at the front, which is harder than you think, but just not using up too many of your teammates. Still a bit of speed in this race today at the moment, but not really kind of full gas as it was yesterday. It's a case of just, you know, remain calm, 7.5 to go, just making sure you get teammates round about you. Trinity getting involved here with that kind of fluorescent green on the blue jersey. But the race leader, as a reminder, everybody, is the rider in the blue body with the red sleeves, Olaf Coy. But Ineos Grenadiers doing a very good job here for Tom Pidcock, just keep him out of trouble. Because you've got stressful running, Matt, it's always important to give your sprinter or your leader more of an armchair ride in towards the finish, because that kind of bumping and accelerating, braking, all that sort of stuff, that just takes the energy out of you.
It certainly is. It certainly does, should I say. We've also got an infiltrator here from the Q36.5 Pro Cycling Team. We've got a solid team here, but no real sprinter amongst their number that I could find. I think Simon Sanyok is reasonably quick, but they're rather looking around for some assistance, or perhaps a teammate that he was hoping to have guided to that point. We can't find him. 6.4k's to go. Let's remind ourselves of the finish of yesterday's stage, because it does look, unless somebody can break the deadlock here, that we are going to be heading for another bunch sprint in the Tour of Britain. The stage one was taken by the man that Brian had just pointed out. Olaf Coy of the Netherlands took his ninth win of the year just ahead of his teammate Wout van Aert. Other riders to look out for in the mix include Sam Bennett of Bora Hansgrohe in the green, Max Kanter of Movistar in the navy blue, Ethan Vernon in the white of Great Britain, Sian Fredheim of the Una X Pro Cycling Team. He's also in the white jersey, but the white jersey of the best young rider. David Bomboy as well, a rider relatively new to us, of Belgium, in the light blue of the TDD Unibet cycling team had a good finish yesterday. And watch out as well for the Irishman, former Irish road champion Rory Townsend, who finished 10th on the stage yesterday. And a couple of riders that missed out yesterday, and I think they're going to want to try and make amends. Luke Lamperty of the Trinity Racing team. Things hotting up at the front here, Brian, as Trinity Racing in that blue livery start to move to the front, neck and neck here with the Ineos Grenadiers.
Yeah, this is what you want to do now. Make sure you stay near the front. You've already battled for that position. Trinity doing a good job. They've got two riders to help out Lamperti. I still think that you need one or two riders inside the last kilometre when it gets very, very technical. But for the moment, the pace is starting to go up now. It wasn't as fast with about 10 kilometres to go through that last village there, but it is increasing the whole time. And you know, you really have to keep calm. GB have been pushed out a little bit. They could do with the kind of moving up in a little bit more numbers. And like we were saying, once we get into the kind of 2 kilometres to go mark, that's the time where you really want to take it on from the front.
It certainly is, isn't it? They've got a strong man on the front here, Magnus Sheffield, just on his road. The experienced Luke Rowe. Is that a little move on the right-hand side? One of the riders from Movistar just moving up on the right. Moving back through to the front as well there in the colours of Jumbo Visma in that waspish black and yellow kit was a Nathan van Hooijdonk, just to try and get a bit of control back on this group as riders continue to ditch. That looks like it's Carlos Barona just out the back, and the other man just tethered to the back wheel. Well, the last rider in the peloton was Fernando Gaviria. He won't participate in the sprint there. Sheffield on the front, 4Ks to go now, Brian. Now, between kilometres 4, 3, 2 and 1, it's relatively straight. A couple of roundabouts, but it's the final K that is the most technical.
Yeah, it's, but what Ineos Grenadiers have done in the red so far is to make sure that Tom Pidcock has got an easy ride. He hasn't had to kind of bump shoulders with anybody for the moment. So Sheffield now has to go as deep as he can, try and keep this tempo as high as possible. Everybody else kind of all over the place. Sam Bennett has moved up. But Borja Hansgrohe starting to move up in the right-hand side. Just as I say that, Ineos Grenadiers move over. It's a challenge, but look at Jumbo Visma over on the right-hand side. They've got their four riders they've already used to today. And it's just a race now, a straight drag race, try and keep to the front. And for the moment, I said that Jumbo Visma, if they do this, what you want to do is get in front of them. You want to kind of push them back, push them further back. You don't want them to dictate it from the front, and that's exactly what they're trying to do at the moment on the left-hand side. They've got Van Hooijdonk, they've got Afini, Wout van Aert, and yesterday's winner and the leader, Olaf Kooi. You want to kind of push over, even if Ineos Grenadiers move over to the right-hand side of the road, just exactly what, you know, Bolton are doing now. Take it on from the front, put your sprinter in the best possible position. Do not let Jumbo Visma dictate this one.
Yeah, this is a good riding by Bolton Equity team. And to see Rory Townsend sat in the second position just on his wheel, one of the riders from Movistar. I think that's a last year's race winner, Serrano. It certainly isn't. Max Kanter coming through the centre now with a big, big push. Borja Hansgrohe with how much firepower they have got under the hood, looking after the Irishman. Sam Bennett disappointed in third, but they've got the whole flotilla of riders on the front here. Borja Hansgrohe take things up at the front, and it's the fearsome German Nils Pollitt driving hard on the front with Ryan Mullen on his wheel. Van Poppel just behind, and then Bennett.
Yeah, this is what you have to do. But just look at Jumbo Visma. They've been pushed back a little bit. Afini's having to ride on the wind, and that's what you want to force them to do. And he's trying to come up now. They're realising they're a little bit too far behind and trying to move up a little bit. So good move so far from Borja Hansgrohe. This is a crucial point. We're heading into some of these kind of central reservations. We're coming into this right-hand corner. So important to get at the front. And that's what Borja Hansgrohe are trying to do. But fighting in the right-hand side, you can see the yellow jerseys of Jumbo Visma. This is a big, big effort from Ryan Mullen now. Perfect positioning, take it on from the front, give Sam Bennett the best opportunity, and it's forcing the hand of Jumbo Visma now.
It certainly is. It is Ryan Mullen on the front, 1,500 metres to go on stage two, Wrexham to Wrexham, the Wrexham stage, and it is Mullen flying on the right side. It's Afini now drag stripping. This is neck and neck here. It really is a drag race. Afini now overtakes Mullen on his wheel. It's Rob Ozecraft on the right-hand side. Couple of riders are down, but unbeknownst to the riders in front, it's still Afini on the front here with Wout van Aert on his wheel. An awful crash. I do hope the riders down there are okay, but this one is forced to split in the bunch. Kooi on the wheel of Van Aert.
Yeah, this is incredible. This is what they did yesterday. This is what the other teams didn't want to happen. But they have gained position. 900 metres to go, right-hand turn. Very little time and opportunity to pop past anybody now. This is exactly almost a carbon copy of what we had yesterday, Mark.
It is indeed. Safini on the front. Well, but on his will, there's a split. There's a couple of rods from DSM trying to bring things back to contention. They're going to be looking after Nicholas Marker, but I think it's between these four or five riders here. It is Van Poppel on the wheel of Olaf Kooi, but one of the DSM runners has managed to get back into contention. This is where the road narrows again. There's a couple of little chicanes before the finish line opens out. It's still Afini on the front. Wout van Aert on the wheel. Olaf Kooi just behind the winner of the opening stage of this race. Van Poppel on the wheel of the Dutchman. Just behind him is Sam Bennett as the sprint opens up and the road opens up to finish now. It's Van Aert hard on the front, but the gap is opening. Kooi on the wheel of the flying man from Belgium. It is on the left-hand side now. The gap is being opened up. So the Kooi launches on the wheel is Van Poppel. On the neck and neck on the left-hand side is Wout van Aert, but Kooi takes another win. Two from two. Olaf Kooi takes the win just ahead. I think it was of Sam Bennett there. But another masterful performance by the young man from the Netherlands. Win number 10 for him. Masterfully led out as well, of course, by Wout van Aert. It's two from two. Brian, that was exciting.
We had a steady day all day, and then we had a super final. Unfortunate, but that crash, it just looked a little bit nasty. They just moved over. I'm not a fan of cones. I don't think cones should be anywhere near a race, but it looked as if one of the riders from DSM just got pushed to the side, clipped that cone, down he came. But what an exciting final that was. Sam Bennett looked a little bit better, but I can only think positioning wasn't the best. I think it was Van Poppel that was in front of him. Probably better that he was on the wheel of Olaf Kooi like he was yesterday, but that was just a battle for that right hand corner at 900 metres ago. We knew that Jumbo Visma had been pushed back at that stage. You know, it was a valiant effort from Bora Hansgrohe, but they just couldn't get round that corner first. At this stage, I think it's Van Poppel and Sam Bennett just in fifth place there. But again, it just looked so easy. That power of Afini to gain that position. And it's just a case of waiting. What else can you do? I think it was Lamperti. It was up there for Trinity, just behind Sam Bennett there in the blue. But they're just kind of hanging on. Serrano was there. Pidcock was there. The junction had been made, but that's a big effort to make inside the last kilometre. And it's a case of Wout van Aert takes over. And just look at the gaps start to appear. They start to open up a little bit more. So from Van Poppel just losing the wheel a little bit, and this is the moment that Sam Bennett comes up. So he's having to make an effort already, and then all of a sudden Olaf Kooi just opens up, and you know, that was it completely. You know, another kind of clean sweep, and it did look as if, was it Sam Bennett finishing in fourth place? I think it was Van Poppel, was it up there? So
I think it was. It was quite narrow, wasn't it, as well, to actually go past. But just look at the way, the power that Wout van Aert had. He was using probably a sprocket or two sprockets lower than Kooi, seated. And his acceleration was so much that even Van Poppel just lost the wheel because of just the raw leg speed of Wout van Aert there. It was impressive. Kooi was in two sprockets higher, had that extra leverage to go past again. Let's have a look at this again. Mullen did an absolutely cracking job here. This is that crash, isn't it?
Whoa.
Oh, that's a nasty crash. Several riders down there. Two from
DSM. Kept
he stayed
up. Unbelievable.
That was awful.
Leaning, leaning on Kooi at the cone. Oh, how did he keep
stayed
that up?
I don't know. I do not know, Brian, how he kept that bike upright. That was an absolutely awful crash. Mullen surveys the scene, but this is when Kooi.
Sam not happier.
No.
No room to move. I think his lead out man got him, but Sam. He got himself in the wrong position. He should have been on Kooi's wheel. Then he'd given himself a chance. He wasn't. I said right from the start, I said, that 900 metre from the line corner, you have to take it from the front. Do not allow Jumbo-Visma to be able to dominate. And he did again.
Here we go. So it's Olaf Kooi takes another win for Jumbo-Visma today. Kooi with the win, Danny Van Poppel in second for Bora Hansgrohe, and Wout van Aert third today. Then we have Sam Bennett of Bora, Max Kanter of Movistar, Ethan Byrne, another solid rider by the young British rider in sixth, Luke Lamperti, good ride from him today in seventh there for Trinity, Stian Fredheim of Norway in eighth, Tom Pidcock solid by the favourite from Ines Grandes there in ninth place, and then another top 10 performance by the Belgian David Bomboy of TDT Unibet Cycling Team. And that's your top 10 on stage 2 of the Tour of Britain. So the leader remains the same. As you said, Brian, that was a real slow burner. Let's hope that the rider went down, as the other identified, is okay. Let's have a look at this again. Mullen took it up. Big turn of speed here by Mullen. I think he did everything right, but this is... Yeah. Affini from this point is on the front for the best part of a kilometre now.
Yeah.
That's awful. He's the only rider down. He's the only rider down, Brian. Oh.
It's just a sandwich here. Olaf Coy gets sandwiched between Bora and bang that cone. I hate seeing cones involved with races at the side of the road. Hate it. Ticker tape and cones. Nowhere near a big race. But, you know, that's very unfortunate and very fortunate only one rider came down.
Yeah, well, there's a situation, but we do hope that that rider is okay. Olaf Coy still leads the Tour of Britain heading into stage three. Wout van Aert in second. Sam Bennett moves up to third. Max Kantor, Danny Van Poppel, Ethan Vernon, Stian Friedheim, David Pomboy, Tom Pidcock up to ninth, and Gonzalo Serrano is there in 10th, the winner of the 2022 edition. So, as you can see, no time differences, no time bonuses on offer in this edition of the Tour of Britain. But breathless stuff in Wrexham, a city arguably more famous for its football of late, but that was nothing short of spectacular. And Jumbo-Visma just got it right, Brian. They rode all day. They had a brief little bit of respite for about 10 or 15 k's and then took it up perfectly. And again, it's just pound for pound raw power, not taking anything away from Bora Hansgrohe. I think actually Bora did a very good job. They anticipated, took it up early. But the key point for me was when Affini drew level with Ryan Mullen and then just pulled Van Aert into position for that final couple of corners. And they had it. And then just that acceleration from Van Aert, seated acceleration, that meant that everybody was just pinned into that position and they were fighting for the minor places. Another demonstration of skill and just raw power.
Yeah, it was a drag race, wasn't it, in the end, and Jumbo-Visma won it again for the second day in a row, and it was very chaotic, and Affini just that little bit more power, and there's nothing you can do. As soon as you're around that corner, it was as you were, you know, you finished in the place you were, and for the second day in a row, so a really exciting nail-biter of a finish, but Jumbo-Visma just nailed that again, and... You know, you can see that they get no help whatsoever today, but they had to really kind of work hard for that one in the finish. But as soon as that they went into the first places in that corner inside the last kilometre, you had the feeling that, you know, it was all over. Carbon copy again, and not a lot you can do. But at least Bora Hansgrohe tried. They tried to get position into that. They just didn't have the big firepower. Of course, they've got strong riders in Ryan Mullen and Niels Pollitt, but to match up with Affini and Wout van Aert, it's just always going to be very difficult. But it's crucial, that 900 metre to go, and they got into it and got the rewards. As we look on upon 15 years away from the Football League, and they won the National League last year and got themselves into the National League. After it's a big football club, this area, Wrexham.
They've got some
famous Hollywood owners, and you know, they've turned it around and back in the Football League.
Indeed, that was a big moment, wasn't it, when they gained promotion. As we look at Olaf Coy warming down, apparently, according to the road book, 300% estimated increase of Wrexham AFC's value since being purchased by the aforementioned Hollywood stars, Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney. Back to the sport of cycling. And it's all smiles for this man in a jersey that I'm becoming very fond of. I do like that retro jersey.
Looks like he's matched up the glasses as well.
It does indeed. Very nice. So, Olaf Coy, two wins from two. Win number 10, so this young man into double digits. And he is only 21 years of age as well. Burst onto the scene a couple of years ago. But, no, they did it all right. Under pressure, but they know how to deliver, and it's all about the details, isn't it? But when you get the details right, in addition, you have the strongest riders in the race, as you just said. It's very difficult. I don't actually think Bora Hansgrohe did anything wrong. Sam Bennett there's calling out, isn't he? We know that. Thing is, Van Poppel is such a good sprinter here as well, isn't it? I mean, there wasn't a lot of space for Bennett to move up, but I think maybe Bennett, in retrospect, would agree that he hasn't quite got just that extra 1%, that little bit of the kick that you need against riders of that opposition. But they secured a second place, and I think they can actually take a lot away from that sprint, to be honest with you, in terms of trying to get Sam and Danny Van Poppel into the right position. But in the end, and they're ever so slightly uphill drag to the line, there was nothing they could do to best the might of Jumbo Visma today.
For the most number of Ironman distance triathlons in a row, I'll end up doing 105
so,
in 105 days.
The crowd now begin to part. They'll be heading towards the podium. I'm not too sure if we will get any podium action for you or not, but we'll stay around for a little while. But what I can talk about is a stage that's coming up tomorrow. Stage 3 takes us to the other side of the country, right across, well, out of Wales, back into England again. We start over in Goole on the east coast, and we head towards Beverley. A more of a traditional length, 154.7 kilometres tomorrow. With two-third category climbs along the way, and also a sprint late on. The climbs come relatively early. I do think we'll see a break go clear tomorrow. And I think we're going to hear from our race leader.
Congratulations on stage win number 2, but a more hectic win today.
Yeah, I mean, it was a short stage, and after yesterday, all the teams were looking at us to control the break. We used two guys to get them back, and then was quite fast towards the last 3K, slightly down, a bit twisty, and then we knew that going into the last K was quite crucial after we did the reckon just before the start of the last K, and we managed to do that, and after that Wout went on the slightly uphill part. And then, everyone is suffering, so and then I just had to go one last bit.
And the bunch sprint was disrupted by a crash, which I don't think you were aware of, but you seemed to brush the shoulder of a DSM rider.
Yeah, I think we went from left to right, and then we squeezed together, and then, that's a nasty crash. I mean, never good to see such things, but I think like you say, we went from left to right, and then got close to the barrier. Yeah.
And so the tactics for Team Jumbo Visma continue, although a more traditional, longer stage tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll have to see. I mean, the guys worked really hard for 2 days in a row now. So we'll be a long and hard week if we keep going like this. So we will see. What the tactics will be for the days to come.
And a short but punchy stage today. What do you get a half day now? Are you allowed to put your feet up?
Yeah. I think I need to go to the podium a few times. So after that we'll go to the hotel and rest up.
Okay. Congratulations again.
Thank you.
Good to hear from our stage winner. And clearly the images he was shown then was his first glimpse of that crash, and never. Good to see, and never nice to see a fellow competitor go down in such a fashion. But I don't think that was the fault of anybody, that was just a racing incident. But I think even Brian, although I totally agree with you about the cones, I actually think he would have hit the curb anyway, the way that his bike had deviated, but the cones certainly didn't help. But I am in full agreement. There were their parking restriction cones and a lay bike to look from the aerial shot there. Still haven't managed to identify the rider that has gone down. He went down pretty hard, but I do hope he is okay. But there you go. It's just one of those things. But that was pretty chaotic. And I still can't quite believe that we didn't see many other riders come down in that crash, Brian, because it looked as if two or three had actually come down. But in fact, it was only that one solitary rider.
Yeah, it was the bike that kind of bounced back, and I was like, oh. But luckily, no one else came down in that other... Second DSM rider was, I don't think he knew much about it. It's one of these incidents where just a bit of luck.
Yeah, you can just see a bit of redevelopment going on there at Wrexham's ground. That's the race course ground. I think we might be going to the podium now. Oh, good stuff. bit more information about Wrexham. They actually played their home games in 1881, 1880, and 1882 at a place called Rodsdew Recreation Ground. They changed their club name to Wrexham Athletic for a season, and then they moved back to the Racehorse Ground for the 1883 and 1884 season, and they've remained there ever since. So well over 140 years of a football in that very same location.
Stage two of the Tour of Britain, back to soccer. The Wrexham stage. Our first presentation will be for our stage winner today. Please welcome onto the podium to make this award the lead member for Place, Economy and Regeneration from Wrexham County Borough Council, Councillor Nigel Williams. And to receive the trophy, the watch, and the prizes, today's stage winner for the team of Jumbo Visma, Olav Kuj.
Watch from Nigel Williams and the bubbly as well. Another win.
Jumbo Visma, your Wrexham stage winner. Going to uncork the bubbly right now.
Jumbo Visma. The Razzie Jumbo Visma pretty used to uncorking bubbly. I wonder if he would chug it like we saw Sepp Kuss do the other day at the Vuelta. That was one of the most impressive chugs I've ever seen. But no chugging, or is it going to be? He's going to have a sip, isn't he? There we go, good lad. More of a modest sip from our stage winner today. What an absolute sensational rider he is.
Well, thanks to Councillor Nigel Williams for presenting that award. We now move
and here's
to
that sprint again.
Of the race leader's jersey. The race
gets very low as well, doesn't he? He's a powerfully built young man. He gets super aero as well. That was a good shot of him, just looking at how low he got Mark compared to Richard. The other riders around him.
And to receive the Tour of Britain race leader's jersey, the bouquet and the magnum, our race leader is for Jumbo Visma, Olav Kuj.
So I think it's, is that Nigel Williams again? Not too sure, but it, I think it is. No, another jersey on the shoulders of Olav Kuj, who will be taking that into stage three of this race. Heading over to the other side of the country, from Goole to Beverley. But I don't think he really wants to have any more, otherwise he'll be a bit tipsy on the Jumbo Visma bus as they head in an easterly direction across the country later on this afternoon.
That award. We'll now move on to the British Cycling Best British Rider. To make this presentation, please welcome the CEO of Welsh Cycling, Caroline Spanton.
And let's look back at what unfolded on another thrilling stage of today's Tour of Britain. Well, thank you very much indeed for joining us. From me, Matt Stevens, and from Brian Smith, it is goodbye. We'll see you tomorrow.